Good afternoon and welcome to Antelope Valley College Marauder Baseball here on SoCalCollegeSports.com today from Lancaster. Game three of this three-game series between Antelope Valley and the visiting L.A. Valley College Monarchs. We are underway with Royce Clayton Jr. at the plate. Freshman right-hander Willem Heilker makes his second start of the season for the Marauders on the bump. Working to Clayton, just missing low and outside. Two balls and a strike. Mentioned Heilker making just his second start of the season overall. His numbers, a record of 1-0, an ERA of 6.30 in 40 innings of work. Misses low and outside, and Clayton Jr. well out in front. Three balls and a strike in 40 innings. Heilker has allowed 49 hits, walked 27, struck out 27. He's a 6'3 freshman. And working to Clayton Jr. with a count of 3-1, and he loses him for a leadoff walk. So L.A. Valley gets a runner aboard to get things going here in the top of the first. This is the rubber game of the three-game set. Game one went to L.A. Valley. That was a 16-4 final at L.A. Valley. Then the venue switched here to Antelope Valley. And the Marauders with a thrilling come-from-behind 5-3 win in Game 2 to even up the series at a game apiece. No balls and a strike on Tyler Olivas. Clayton Jr. with good speed on at first. We're just underway. Warm temperatures in the high desert, a game-time temperature of 78 degrees, and you figure that number to creep into the 80s as the afternoon wears on. The wind right now at 10 miles an hour. And we'll see if that freshens up. Meanwhile, they have Clayton Jr. hung up between first and second. And still waiting on the call. And it looks like Clayton Jr. was able to make it to second. So they had him picked off momentarily. But Clayton Jr. with the great speed able to nonetheless pick up the stolen base and get to second. So a runner in scoring position right away for the Monarchs with Olivas at the plate. Outstanding pitcher's duel in game two. And the Marauders with a four-run seventh inning against the Monarch bullpen. That one cued back to the screen to pull out another victory here at home where they've been very tough all season. Over 500 here in Lancaster. And this once again proving to be a tough place to come and play. Monarchs will try to win the series here today. Hard line drive into right field. Clayton Jr. gonna tag, and the throw will come in from Rogers. So one down. And a runner at third for the Monarchs. So Olivas retired on the fly ball to right, but a scoring opportunity for L.A. Valley, and they have just the bat that they would like to have up at the plate in catcher Bobby Velasco, who is having a tremendous season and a monster series. His batting average at .340, two home runs, 19 runs batted in. Both those home runs came in the opener. Fly ball center field plenty deep as Zhang will retreat and make the catch, but Clayton Jr. will score standing up, and the Monarchs are on the board as the leadoff walk to Clayton Jr. leads to a run for the Monarchs here in the top of the first. Well, solid baseball from L.A. Valley here in the top of the first. They get Clayton Jr. aboard. His speed gets him to second, but Olivas does a good job taking it to the right side with a fly ball. Good base running as Clayton Jr. advances, and then Velasco, first pitch swinging, hits one to deep center and brings the run home. So once again, the Monarchs grab the lead as we are joined by Emery Johnson. Two balls and no strikes. Sean David, the batter, goes after a ball there. And this is going to be a fair ball, and Uribe will go to first to retire the side. So Heilker out of the inning, but the Monarchs draw first blood. A run on no hits, the leadoff walk gets L.A. Valley on the board. Through half an inning, L.A. Valley 1, AVC coming to bat on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Freshman left-hander Drew Gustafson gets the start for L.A. Valley here today, his ninth appearance of the season, his fourth start, a record of 1-2, and an ERA of 4.24 in 23 and a third innings. First pitch to Jack Rogers in for a strike. Well, we saw a terrific pitcher's duel yesterday. And today, the Monarchs grab the early lead in the top of the first, and now Gustafson will go to work trying to follow up on the terrific effort of Daniel Tovar yesterday, albeit in a losing effort. Ground ball back up the middle, diving stop from Valdez to his feet, and in time to get Rogers' highlight reel from Tino Valdez ranging to his left and robbing Rogers of a base hit. Valdez and Torres, along with Clayton Jr. up the middle, give the Monarchs outstanding defense. And that was a tremendous play from Valdez, and it'll bring up Zach Terry. Just off the outside corner for a ball. Well, much like Tovar yesterday, Gustafson coming off arguably his best outing of the season in his last outing a week ago. Swing and a miss. Terry comes up empty. A ball and a strike. It was a 3-0 win for Valley at home against L.A. Mission. And Gustafson went 5 innings of shutout ball. Gave up 3 hits, walked 3, struck out 4. As the Monarchs combined on a shutout against L.A. Mission. 2 balls and a strike. So once again, the Marauders will have to go to work against, if nothing else, a very confident pitcher, Andrew Gustafson. Terry swinging and fouls it away. 2 balls and 2 strikes. Zach Terry comes in batting 290. Five home runs, 28 runs batted in. Awful lot of power for Terry at second base. And batting second in the lineup, here's the 2-2. Again, trying to go the opposite way. Start to set the defense for you for the Monarchs. Elvis Park in left, Royce Clayton Jr. in center, Tyler Olivas in right. The infield from third to first, Sean David, Tino Valdez, Luis Torres, Will White. The battery, Bobby Velasco behind the plate, and Drew Gustafson on the mound. Here's the 2-2 to Terry. Slow curve outside for a ball. Well, Tovar was excellent yesterday for LA Valley, but the Marauders, while struggling to put up any runs against Tovar, were very effective in terms of pitch count, long at bats, and they were able to knock Tovar out for the start of the seventh inning, and then they were able to make a comeback against the Monarch bullpen as Terry, frozen with the breaking ball, is down on strikes for out number two. Tovar had nearly 100 pitches through six innings. And yeah, Dave Malice made the decision to go to the bullpen. Hello, Emery.
Yeah,
glad
hello.
To have you.
I am
That'll bring up Keon Mosseni.
Well, and Keon Mosseni, I mean, is there a storyline that we can't talk about here? I mean, just huge in both games. He had the home run in the first inning on Thursday, and, you know, I mean, he was walked two times later in the game and never was able to score, but he's been a huge difference maker for this Marauders team, and there's nothing that we can't say that's positive about this guy in the lineup.
I mean, Keon Mosseni, if nothing else, he's got to love it that we're here. He's got two home runs on the season. They're both here on SoCalCollegeSports.com.
Oh, yeah.
Hit for the cycle last week against Bakersfield with the cameras on. So he's coming up even bigger with the cameras here. He's batting .455, two home runs, 32 runs batted in. Here's the 2-1 inside from Gustafson.
And Jeff, just to reiterate that number again, he's batting a cool .455 right now. You know, no big numbers or anything like that.
Just a freshman. How exciting is it for Brian Moses to have this guy in the lineup? And he works another walk, and that is getting to be something of a familiar refrain as well for Mosseni. Is I think the word is getting around to opposing pitchers that this is a guy that you need to be careful when you're pitching to him.
He's just added to his on-base percentage right now, sitting at .580. So this guy not only hits the ball really well, but he walks. In his at-bats, he's been walked 16 times, make that 17 now. That's a problem right there to deal with as a pitching staff. And when you're talking about extending at bats, this is exactly what they're doing.
Back through the box and a base hit for Jabara. So the Marauders trying to get something going with two outs, a walk to Mosseni, a base hit for Jabara, two on, two out, and that'll bring up Joe Uribe. I was going to say with Mosseni, just to complete the tour around the five tools of baseball, he also has eight stolen bases and hasn't been caught stealing.
Oh,
so he runs the bases well as well. Two on, two out. Here's Uribe. Comes in batting .356, a home run, 20 runs batted in.
Uribe, really good behind the plate for the Marauders in the couple games that we've covered for them. I have to say he's done a very good job of making sure, you know, no wild pitches really get out of the way from his presence. He's been very effective in making sure these pitchers feel confident when he's behind the plate.
No balls and a strike as Gustafson gets the call at the knees. Four strike one. Working from the stretch, Mosseni away from second. Breaking ball over for a strike. Uribe in a hole, no balls and two strikes. A little trouble for Gustafson early.
Thursday he was
got Rogers on the ground out, fan Terry, but then a walk to Mosseni and a base hit for Jabara. Here's the 0-2. Low for a ball.
That's a good miss there from Gustafson. You know, with that kind of breaking ball 0-2, a lot of guys, especially, you know, when they're fresh out of high school, they make the mistake of trying to go too firm with their breaking ball and just try to lay one in there into the strike zone. And that's a college hitter is going to recognize that pitch immediately and to try to take advantage of it. So that's not a bad miss there on an 0-2 count.
1-2, swing and a miss, and Uribe down on strikes to retire the side. Gustafson able to get out of the jam with no runs across. No runs, one hit, no errors, two left on base. We're through one. L.A. Valley 1, AVC nothing here on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Freshman Willem Heilker making his first start since April 1st. His last three appearances have been in relief. His last outing as he misses high and inside. He went three innings a week ago at Bakersfield at in relief in a game that the Marauders won 16-14. Bounced foul. A ball and a strike. It'll be Will White, Elvis Park, and Brandon Cuervo here in the top of the second with the Monarchs leading at 1-0. Will White comes in batting .246 in on the hands. And a bouncer to Taylor, who will go across to retire White for out number one. Well, that was good location from Heilker. Got that ball inside and jammed White. Ends up being a softly hit ball. And Taylor over for out number one. That'll bring up Park. Elvis Park, the sophomore, batting .296. Two home runs, 13 runs batted in. First pitch swinging to Taylor, who has it for out number two. Good job by Taylor to stay with this one. A sinking line drive. Let's give you one more look as it's quickly two down here in the top of the second. Watch Heilker again working inside. And that ball moving down on Taylor, but stays with it. Quickly two down. That'll bring up Brandon Cuervo, who makes his first appearance here in Lancaster, getting the start today. Outside for a ball. Cuervo batting .257, a home run, 15 runs batted in. Sophomore back in the lineup as the designated hitter. Here's the 1-0 inside, two balls and no strikes. Well, Heilker still working on a no-hitter. He was undone by the leadoff base on balls to Royce Clayton Jr., accounting for the only run of the game. Here's the 2-0. Good drop, but gets the call, two balls and a strike on Cuervo. Luis Torres waits on deck if Cuervo can keep it going here in the top of the second.
I really like that pitch, Jeff. And he goes back to back.
Yeah, there's a lot to like there.
Yeah. Well, no, just coming back, you throw two fastballs and you're a little bit you're trying to be a little bit too fine with them. Don't get the calls you want, maybe a little wild. He looks like he's comfortable with his breaking ball there, and so he goes back to back with it and he draws the foul.
2-2, low for a ball. And what do you see from that pitch? Because it's got an awful lot of drop on it, but it also looks to me, Emery, like pretty good velocity.
Sorry, say that question one more time, Jeff. I'm still sorting out.
I was curious about that pitch because it definitely has some sinking action, but also a lot of velocity. Is that a good hard sinker? Back to the screen.
Very well could be a sinker. It looked like from his delivery that he was throwing some sort of breaking ball. The other thing is that it could very easily be a slider here. Yeah, no, that's a curveball grip through and through right there, and that wasn't the pitch that.
Well, that was the pitch.
Yeah, that was a
curveball. That made it 3-2.
Yeah.
Through the hole on the left side, a two-out single for Cuervo. We'll keep the inning going for the Monarchs.
Yeah, Jeff, he just beat him there. That's all that was. He had found it very comfortable, and sometimes you get in the rhythm of throwing a breaking ball over and over and over again because it's what's working. And sometimes even when you're in a full count, you want to try and double up with that breaking ball. But the hitter knew that's what was coming up.
Breaking ball over for a strike, no balls, and a strike to Luis Torres. And, you know, I think if you're Brian Moses, you like the fact also that with the bases empty, he was around the plate. Better to make him hit the ball and let your defense have a chance to do some work than simply to put him on trying to be too fine. Fly ball, shallow center, and it's Rogers who will move over and take it in front of Zhang to retire the side. Three down. We'll head to the bottom of the second, 1-0 L.A. Valley. It's Marauder Baseball here on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Trey Thomas set to lead things off in the bottom of the second with LA Valley on top 1-0. You're watching Marauder Baseball. You're on SoCalCollegeSports.com. It'll be Thomas to be followed by Mason Johnson and Jason Zhang against Drew Gustafson. Curveball high for a ball, one ball, and no strikes. You look at Gustafson's ERA, 4.24 on the season. But that was after a particularly tough outing in his first outing of the season against Folsom Lake. But in his last 12 and two-thirds innings, Gustafson with an ERA of 1.42. So as is often the case, it's a different pitcher than the numbers might indicate, given when you see the pitcher in the season. Gustafson has obviously settled into more of a groove, breaking ball high, two balls and a strike. Trey Thomas comes in batting .325. Two home runs, 30 runs batted in. But on a warm and windy day, big swing and a miss. Count even up at 2-2. This is one of the tougher assignments that you can have in the 3C2A, coming here to Lancaster to work against this Marauder lineup. 2-2 to Thomas. Low for a ball.
Jeff, it definitely depends on when the wind is blowing. Right now, the flag is completely down. There is no wind in the air. Yesterday, we were moving horses from one ranch to another about 5 miles away from where we started, and it was 95 degrees outside. So we're well into the season of summer.
Down the right field line, playable for Olivas for out number one. So one down, that'll bring up Mason Johnson. And again, figure pitch count to be a storyline. Another full count, but Gustafson, another pitcher throwing the ball well, and the Marauders certainly would like to take their chances getting into the bullpen.
Yeah, he's already got 25 pitches, Jeff, through 1 1/3 inning.
And a ball to Johnson. Johnson comes in batting .295, 3 home runs, 26 runs batted in. In his sophomore season, hot shot through the box and a base hit. So Johnson aboard with a one-out single.
He does exactly. He's waiting for that fastball coming in, Jeff. That's exactly what he wanted to do with it. Hit something hard up the middle and get on base. One out.
Second hit of the game for Antelope Valley. And that'll bring up Zhang. Jason Zhang, a freshman, batting .294, no home runs, 25 runs batted in. And he had a big double yesterday in that comeback win, helping to ignite the big four-run inning in the seventh that put the Marauders on top, and they held on for the 5-3 win. Here's the 0-1. Bouncing ball to short. Valdez goes to second for one. The turn from Torres not in time. So Zhang able to leg it out. Two down. And a runner still at first, and that'll bring up Jack Taylor. Taylor having a terrific sophomore season, taking over at shortstop for outstanding shortstop Arif Camacho. Arif Camacho moved on to Wagner College after two outstanding seasons at AVC. And Taylor has stepped in, and he's batting .333 this season. Inside for a strike. Gets the inside corner with the breaking ball. No balls and a strike. And we've seen both pitchers here today show a willingness to work inside and effectively. Seen a couple of jam shots early. Here's the 0-1. And now to the outside corner, and he's quickly on top of Taylor. No balls and two strikes. Zhang at first with good speed. But at 0-2, not exactly a count where you can do a whole lot, one would think, if you're Brian Moses. Low for a ball. One ball, two strikes. Top of the order, Jack Rogers on deck. If Taylor can keep something going here in the bottom of the second. Now Gustafson will go to first, and they've got the runner down to second in time to get Zhang and retire the side. So a good move from Gustafson gets him out of the inning. No runs, one hit, no errors, nobody left. We're heading to the top of the third from Lancaster. LA Valley on top of AVC, 1-0 on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Top of the third, it'll be Tino Valdez, and then the top of the order, Royce Clayton Jr. and Tyler Olivas against Willem Heilker. Valley on top, 1-0 on the sacrifice fly from Velasco in the top of the first. First pitch in for a strike to Valdez.
Jeff, he was 2-for-3 on Thursday, but I want to remind everybody how he got on base. Do you remember how he got on base three of the times he was up to the plate?
Well, it was – they were of infield hits, if memory serves.
Yeah, he had bunts for both of his base hits that he had. But in the scorebook, it could be a base hit off the wall. You never know.
Right, exactly. It's a hard line drive for a base hit. In the scorebook, they all – all look the same for Valdez. Freshman batting .259, no home runs, 21 runs batted in. We've already seen the glove work from Valdez earlier in this one. Robbing Rogers of a base hit. Goes the opposite way. Well, there's a clean single.
Yep.
Rogers will cut it off. But that's a no-doubter from Valdez and a leadoff base hit. It's almost as if he heard you.
Yeah,
all right, I'll take one to the outfield.
Say, Jeff,
come up with hits any number of ways. And for Valdez, yet another hit and the leadoff batter aboard with the top of the order coming up. And things get a little more tense for freshman Willem Heilker with a man on. And now he'll work to Clayton, who walked his first time up. There goes the runner. Throw down from Uribe. In time, they get Valdez. So the leadoff hit erased as Uribe delivers a strike to get Valdez trying to steal. Looked like they went to the hit and run. As there he goes, and Clayton just swings through the breaking ball. And you see the good throw from Uribe and the tag from Terry. So one down.
Well, Jeff, I was going to say they had pretty much everything you'd want in a hit-and-run type situation. A breaking ball was thrown, the batter did swing, and the runner had broke on time. But what they didn't account for was exactly how good Uribe is behind the plate. And that is I just mentioned it earlier, I want to say, in the first inning. And, he continues to show us how good he is behind the plate.
Yeah, the Monarchs aggressive on the base pass, 52 stolen bases as a team. Swing and a miss from Clayton, 2 balls and 2 strikes. Clayton Jr. comes in batting .282, a home run, 23 runs batted in. And now with the bases empty, after Uribe erases Valdez. Breaking ball, and Clayton gets a piece to stay alive. Clayton has struck out 26 times on the season, so he's aggressive in that leadoff spot. 2-2, back to the screen again. It's another good at-bat for Royce Clayton Jr. This will be the 7th pitch that he sees after working a walk leading off the game. So he is aggressive, but making Heilker work in that leadoff spot. Exactly what he's supposed to do, breaking ball outside and another full count. 3 balls, 2 strikes. Here's the payoff. Low for a ball. Another walk for Clayton Jr., who has now 19 stolen bases on the season after he stole 2nd after a walk in the first. Well, now the play from Uribe looms a little bit larger with Clayton aboard. And another dangerous spot for Heilker with the fleet-footed Clayton Jr. at first and a throw over from Heilker immediately.
Yeah, this is one of those situations where you want to continue to check your runner at first base, make sure they don't get too aggressive away from the bag. And you see that's already shortened up his lead a little bit. He was standing almost by the first cut of the grass.
Olivas came in batting .319, a home run, 21 runs batted in. Fly to right his first time up. And they'll check Clayton again. 1 ball, no strikes on Olivas. Heilker ready. Pop fly out of play on the right side. A ball and a strike on Olivas. And it looked to me again like Olivas looking to hit the ball to that right side, maybe eyeing the hole between first and second with them holding Clayton aboard. 1-1. Well, part of it, you imagine, for Hauker is keeping Clayton's lead short if he can get a ground ball to give you a better chance perhaps to turn two. Two balls and a strike. More so than just trying to prevent the stolen base, which is certainly part of the picture. But you think ahead to the possibility of turning two if you can get a ground ball. Here's a 2-1. High chopper. And Terry and Taylor with some trouble. Now it gets into shallow center. Clayton Jr. all the way to third. And Olivas running hard will make it to second. This will be interesting to see how they score it. As Terry and Taylor both moving over. Someone's got to field the ball. Someone's got to cover second. And they're just not on the same page on a very awkward play. Let's watch it again from behind.
Yeah, that's just going to be an error credited to the second baseman for coming over and touching the ball. The base runner is just being heads up with how they were running around the bases, and that's how you end up with runners at second and third. That's kind of those kind of situations that you want to prevent, because when your defense starts getting confused or starts making decisions that are detrimental to how they're going to play there, ultimately, and I don't know if they're officially going to score it as an error, but that's an error in my book. It is official, at least in live score.
And it gets away from Uribe. But Uribe able to get to it quickly enough that Clayton Jr. will remain at third. One ball, no strikes, one down, and some trouble for Hauker. So close to potentially even getting out of the inning. But one of those balls that is just in an incredibly awkward spot. And the error puts runners at second and third, off speed, in for a strike. A ball and a strike on Sean David, or I should say on Bobby Velasco. Velasco with a sacrifice fly his first time up. Swing and a miss. And Emery, help me out here a little bit, because this is Sean David at the plate.
Yes.
And I don't know if I lost a player. Okay. All right. Yeah, they intentionally walked Bobby Velasco.
That is what I'm missing as well. Okay. Yeah, Jeff.
Right. Okay. a wave and a miss from David. Or did he get a piece and now Uribe is down and toughest position that you can find in not just baseball, but it's up there with any sport, is they take a beating back there. And let's see if we could see what happened as Uribe is down. And no doubt the bat got a piece of him.
Oh, yeah. Jeff, we're going to that's the reason why we're here.
Or was that a ball that ended up in, shall we say, an awkward spot?
Yes, that's exactly where we're going to go with that, Jeff. That's a tough one.
Okay.
For sure. You know, you like to think that a cup is going to protect you, but there are definitely situations, where – and I played the position of catcher when I was in high school. Before I switched to pitcher only, I got a little too large for the position. But there are some times where just it's going to not sit completely where it needs to, and the ball can actually bounce up and cause the cup to hit you in the wrong place. And that's probably what I'm guessing is what just happened right there.
And I imagine that they're still looking at Uribe, but this patriotic moment brought to you by SoCal College Sports. All right. So back to action. David did just get a piece, and that is significant. With two strikes, he's still alive. So the bases are loaded. A count of 1-2 on David, who grounded back to the mound his first time up. Fly ball right field. Rogers ranging over to the line, has the catch. The throw coming home, not in time. Clayton Jr. with the great speed, going to score on the sacrifice fly from David to push the lead to 2-0. So another run via the sacrifice fly. This time it's David bringing home Clayton Jr. So two down, it's 2-0, and This is a huge batter early in this game for Willem Hjelker. Unfortunate error early in the inning, but if he can get away with just one run allowed, the Marauders absolutely still in it. And, Emery, this is where I know Brian Moses and the ABC coaches would love to see their young right-hander just bear down and get out of this inning. Keep it to one run. Keep yourself in the game with a long way to go. In for a strike.
Yeah, and that's a good fastball reset for him. You know, just throwing a firm pitch on the outside corner, get the strike across the board, and, you know, he's got two outs. You know, all he has to do is allow his field to make the play here. There's no stress for the strikeout. Just keep the ball low here.
Hot shot to Johnson from his knees to throw across.
How about it, Elvis Clark?
And not quite in time, but Johnson does a good job of keeping that on the infield, and instead of another run in, it's an infield hit and the bases are loaded. So still a chance as White is aboard with a single, and it'll bring up Park. I'll tell you, Johnson from his knees.
Yeah. You know, it's
that is exactly the kind of arm that you expect to see at third base, but almost got him.
Yeah, Jeff,
for a strike.
I don't know how well the main camera had the angle because I was watching the play happen in real time, but I think he was only safe by about a step.
Yeah, it was close. It was bang, bang. And White, hustling down the line, gets the infield hit, keeps the inning going. And a chance for the Monarchs to take command early if they can come up with a base hit here. They'll appeal down, didn't go around, count evened up at a ball and a strike. Elvis Park lined to short his first time up. Came in batting .296, two home runs, 13 runs batted in. Park in the lineup more and more as this season has gone on and has played exceptionally well over the last few weeks, raising that average up near the 300 mark from about .260 3 weeks ago. Meanwhile, swing and a miss, and the count now a ball and two strikes.
So, Jeff, what you're saying is he's seen the ball well.
Indeed he is. He's now 3-for-8 in the series after the lineout with three runs batted in, and he's got a chance to add to that number big time if he can come up with a base hit here. The 1-2, low and outside, Uribe able to keep it in front, two balls and two strikes. Olivas at third, Velasco at second, Will White at first. And Hjelker trying to get out of this third inning. Line drive over the head of Terry. This is going to score at least two. It's going to get to the track. And Park going to clear the bases with a double.
Jeff made
that
a triple.
Valley now leads it 5-0 as Park indeed ends up at third. So call it a triple. But of substantially more importance is the three runs that Park brings home with that gapper. And for Hjelker, an unfortunate three unearned runs here in the top of the third. And we'll have a mound visit. And, well, you so often see it at every level of baseball. What you do with two outs and runners on base is going to have a big impact on the result of the game. And you give the Monarchs a lot of credit here. After two were down, they've been able to bring home four runs. Excuse me, three runs with the Park triple. But that is a timely hit for Elvis Park. And the Monarchs with the big early lead now at 5-0. As Cuervo will stand in and take the fastball for a strike. Cuervo, the eighth man to bat in the inning. Breaking ball outside. One ball and one strike. Well, you look at the scores on the season, particularly here in Lancaster, and you could be sure that Cuervo would love to pick up Park here. Every run can end up being very important. Teams getting into double digits, both teams getting into double digits, is a fairly common occurrence, especially if the wind picks up here in Lancaster.
Well, and the wind, just as you say that, is picking up the flag going out to direct center. And I don't know where that pitch was.
A little bit low. Well, Emery, I think it's interesting when a pitcher starts to struggle or when a pitcher is in a groove, it appears to me as I watch that it starts sometimes to have an impact on the strike zone.
Right.
And Hauker is struggling this inning.
Yeah, that pitch was a little bit low. I think the umpire made the right call there. You know, the problem is he hasn't been able to execute that kind of low fastball all day. And the umpire is just not accustomed to seeing it. And, you know, you might be able to draw that call earlier on in the game if you consistently continue to produce that pitch. But, you know, it's been very tough. He's had to rely on his curveball for control. His fastball has been a little bit erratic. And then whenever he's throwing a good fastball, it's usually been over the middle of the zone, and hitters have been able to take advantage of it.
Torres at the plate as the Monarchs have batted around. It's quickly no balls and two strikes. On Luis Torres, he flied to right his first time up. Torres comes in batting 278, no home runs, 9 runs batted in. And now a throw down to second, and the throw gets away. That's going to bring home the run after Hauker had Cuervo hung up between first and second, but just guides the throw, and we'll watch this from behind. And it's turning into a nightmare.
Jeff,
of a third inning.
This is exactly what happens when your team has already committed an error in an inning and things start to get out of hand and the pitcher is starting to get exhausted at this point. You've thrown almost through the entire lineup. And in that situation, there's two ways to go about it. Well, that ends the inning. Never mind.
Torres down on strikes to finally end the inning, but the Monarchs bat around and bring home 5 runs. We head to the bottom of the third, LA Valley on top of ABC 6-0. Here on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Now the Marauders going to have to dig themselves out of a hole once again here at home. They trail it 6-0. Jack Taylor back at the plate. He was at the plate when Zhang was thrown out to end the second inning. No balls and a strike on Taylor. It'll be Taylor to be followed by Rogers and Zach Terry. 9-1-2 coming up in the bottom of the third. As Drew Gustafson back on the bump, curveball. Back up the middle and a base hit for Taylor. So the Marauders will look to answer back here in their half of the third, and they get it going with a base hit by Terry. That'll bring up Rogers, who grounded to short his first time up. Jack Rogers came in with 5 home runs, 20 runs batted in, batting average at .263. See if they could string together a couple of hits here and get Keon Mosenny to the plate. 1 ball and no strikes. They've got some work to do after a 5-run top of the inning for the Monarchs. Outside for a ball, 2 balls and no strikes.
Well, Jeff, he's at 35 pitches into his third inning. And the Marauders are doing a really good
high
job
for
of
a ball.
Letting them make those mistakes and throw into deep counts right here. And that should be their aggressive tactic.
Well, I'm constantly impressed, Emery, with the Marauders up and down the lineup. There's no panic in this lineup. They're a very confident hitting team. And, you know, here at the bottom of the third, that the feeling is they've got a lot of time.
Yes.
And you can just tell up and down this lineup that there's a lot of confidence that they can put runs on the board.
Yeah, they've proven they could do it in the past. It wasn't an issue against Bakersfield. I mean, if you think about that game way back 2 weeks ago when we were calling, at a certain point, the game, I think the difference was almost 7 runs. And, you know, for the Marauders, it's going, well, we still have outs left. You know, the ninth inning isn't over. So, you know, the wind is dead right now, and that can oftentimes play a factor here. But, regardless, is these guys can hit the heck out of the ball, and it's not the end of the world, considering that their lineup has proven, especially late in innings, they can come back and get ahead.
Light gusts up to about 10 miles an hour. Full count on Rogers. Here's the payoff pitch. High for a ball. 2 on. Nobody out to start the bottom of the third. Well, that's exactly what you don't want if you're Gustafson.
Another long pitch walk. He's got no outs. Now runners first and second.
And that brings up Terry. And Terry is struggling in the series, still hitless at 0-for-8 with a couple of walks. But if you're a Marauder fan, this guy is an awfully good hitter, and you got a hunch he's due. First pitch swing, ground ball to short, could be 2. Over to second for 1, the relay in time. That is a big double play for Drew Gustafson and the Monarchs. 6-4-3, 2 down on the play. Taylor does advance to third, but never will you see the term pitcher's best friend more applicable than right here.
This is just your defense doing exactly what you need them to do. Pitchers who find ways to get ground balls in tough situations like this, that's what's going to help your team and keep your pitch counts low. And that's how you know a guy is really trusting of the guys around him when he's on the mound.
Good breaking ball in for a strike to Mosenny. Mosenny, a walk his first time up. And now we'll see if Mosenny can pick up Taylor at third and at least get the Marauders on the board. 0-1 pitch. Slow curve inside for a ball. 1 ball, 1 strike. Aiden Jabara, who rather quietly was the hero in game 2 with a couple of hits, but of most importance was the 2-out, 2-run single in the 7th that gave the Marauders the eventual margin of victory. Ground ball in the hole. Torres trying to go to first and gets it to the pitcher covering. What a play. That's a great job by Gustafson. Let's keep it here. And Emery, this is a ball that's in a really tough spot. Torres ranges to his left, but watch the hustle off the mound from Gustafson.
You know, Jeff, we'll send it to break right after this point, but I want to say that's something that you have to recognize immediately as a pitcher. If you hesitate one little bit there, that Mosenny is safe at first base. That you have to make a heck of a sprint to go 60. You know, it's 60 feet 6 inches to home plate. It's about the same distance to first base. Actually, it's a little bit more. So you have to ensure that you're going to get as fast off that mound and know exactly where your covering spot is. That was a great job by
and speaking.
By
yeah, and speaking of fast, maybe we can run that one more time. But I don't know if Drew Gustafson runs track, but he might want to consider it because watch the speed as he makes up the ground. That's about as fast from the mound to first base as I've ever seen getting over there. And he's there in front of Mosseni by a step as Torres delivers a good throw to get him out of the inning unscathed.
Well, Jeff, that will send us to the top.
Well, we'll stay here for the top of the fourth. And, Emery Johnson will take over on play-by-play here for the middle innings.
Oh, thank you, Jeff. Man, hard to think that we had to work our way all the way through. And now we're in the fourth inning. Man, time flies when you're having fun. This will bring up Tino Valdez to the plate. He takes strike one, breaking ball. Now, this inning is really, really important for William Hyoker. He needs to make sure that he keeps his pitch count low and gets his team at least to the fifth. It's really, really difficult for your bullpen to try and pick up on the slack when you give them, you know, four, five, six innings of work. And in this instance, had he gone out in the third, that would have been six frames that they would have had to fill back. Comes back with ball number two.
Yeah, in game two, just two pitchers. As Toledo and Maudsley combined in the 5-3 win. So Brian Moses does have pretty much everyone available, but it's a tough assignment when you start having to go to multiple pitchers, two balls and two strikes.
Comes back with a fastball high in the zone that brings the count full. Yeah, Tino Valdez last time, he had a base hit into right field on the ground, but he was caught stealing. And that was what we thought was going to be a very pivotal out, considering Royce Clayton walked immediately afterwards. Well, he takes the walk now. And the first base runner of the inning will be Tino Valdez. That'll bring up Royce Clayton Jr., who was up just last inning. He walked. He also walked in the first and had a stolen base.
That's the third time in four innings that Hyoker has put the leadoff man on base, and in the previous two times, it did lead to a run or more for the Monarchs.
Well, and I'm privy to this angle because I can see it, Jeff. The bullpen is now getting activated, and I think Coach sees something a little bit here, and I'm sure the average regular baseball fan would understand when you start seeing a pitcher getting busy like this. Bunt placed down by Clayton Jr. Throw over from Uribe on time. The out will be recorded at first, but not before Tino Valdez moves to second base. Point we were trying to make just before was you can tell that he's physically getting a little bit tired out on the mound. He's expended a lot of energy, thrown a lot of pitches in three innings. I don't have the exact count right now.
Yeah, Clayton Jr. in a tie for the team lead in sacrifices on the season, handles the bat well, gets the runner into scoring position for Olivas.
Comes in, strike one, called right down the middle of the plate. Olivas sack flew out, moving the pivotal runner in the first inning. That was Royce Clayton the first time he was up to the plate to second base, or check that third base, which eventually led to the sacrifice fly from Bobby Velasco. Breaking ball high for a ball. That brings the count even 1-1. Outfield pretty much playing straight away here. Checking the runner at second. Popped up right side. This one looks like it's going to be playable and drifting over towards the fence. Nope, just out of play. Adrian Jabara trying to do his best to get over there, but he is not, in fact, 10 feet tall, Jeff, and I don't think he can reach over the fence. Well, strike number two.
Well, Emery, you're there at the ballpark. Is the prevailing wind blowing a little bit left to right? Because that was a ball that looked like it started, like it might be playable, and then just made it out of play to give Olivas another life.
The wind is blowing pretty much right to left at this time and a little bit straight out to left. It keeps shifting back and forth, but not quite left to right. Olivas with a choked up bat fouls one back to the right side again. This one will be out of play. Count stays at 1-2. Here comes the 1-2. Runner's not looking like he's going to go here. Breaking ball right into his back, and he's going to take first base. You hear the bench from L.A. Valley College getting really excited. As they'll have their second base runner.
Well, it's a big break for the Monarchs as well with a 1-2 count, and instead of working ahead on Olivas, you lose him and put him on base. Five walks and now a hit batsman for Halker today. And you factor in a couple of miscues in the field, and this has been one of those outings for Heilker where it could have been a much different story. Some of it he's done to himself, and some of it's been a little bit of bad luck.
Remember that error that happened. I mean, Tyler Olivas was the guy who hit the ground ball. It was just a chopper up the middle. And unfortunately, when the second baseman had come over, Zach Terry, and he's been very good. I don't want this to come off the wrong way. Terry's been very good, especially in the series. But he came over and tried to make a play on the ball, and that's how you ignite an inning like this, and one error turns into two, and suddenly you have five runs aboard. Now, two runners on, only one out, and that brings up to the plate Bobby Velasco. Last time up, he walked. Pick over to second base. Not in time.
Yeah, Valdez had gotten off to a pretty good lead and had to scramble back. How good has Velasco been in this series? He now has 9 runs batted in the series. We're only in game 3.
Oh, my goodness. Well, and that's why he's sitting as your number 3 hitter as well in the lineup. That's usually your most consistent hitter. 4 is, you know, sometimes people go, oh, you want to be the 4 hitter in the lineup. 4 hitter in the lineup is the guy who's hitting the most home runs. But the 3 hitter is the guy you want to be able to put the first 2 batters that you have in your lineup across the plate. And that's the reason why Velasco is up to, in the position that he's in this lineup. Ball 1. It's a 1-0 count. Here comes the next pitch. And that's a breaking ball outside. Uribe looking for the ball at his feet, and I think he was a little bit dazed for a second, and that's just going to be a straight steal on a passed ball. Moves the runners over, both into scoring position, now 90 feet away. And this turns kind of this desperate situation, 2-0 count with one out. You need to get an out here with preserving the runs on base and not allowing them to score.
It does open up first with a 2-0 count, so you don't have to really go after Velasco here.
Fastball belt high. Or strike number 1. That's a dangerous pitch to continue to throw. There you have a look at Tino Valdez. Marauders desperately looking for an out here. Here comes the 2-1 right off the glove, and that's going to bring in a run, maybe 2. Ball played into the center field, and that will bring in the second run. So a 2-run single by Bobby Velasco. And, Jeff, you said 9. Make it 11 runs batted in this series alone.
Well, timely hitting and coming up consistently with runners on base, and that'll do it. And it's yet another tough break for Halker out on the mound as he had the glove on it. But it just gets over the glove as you saw it ricochet off the top of his glove. But he nearly came up with it. And it's one of those breaks that just didn't go the way of the Marauders on a well-hit ball from Velasco. But it's so often a game of inches.
The pitchers are still warming up in the bullpen, but I have a feeling that this might be the last inning for Heilker.
Well, Heilker's up over 80 pitches.
Line drive into left field, and that's going to move the runner over. And that's another base hit for Sean David.
Now batting Will White.
And I think fatigue now starting to be an issue for Hauker over the first three-plus innings. It had been more a case of walks and some untimely miscues, but not necessarily hard-hit balls. But now the last couple of balls by Velasco and David have been barreled up. And you suspect that Hauker is starting to get a little gassed out there.
Well, and it looks like this is going to be it for Hauker. He had a couple moments here where he could have gotten out of the innings, and, you know, it's just been a tough outing all around for him. Well, we'll see the new pitcher come in just a few moments. We'll take a quick break. You're watching SoCal College Sports coverage of Marauder Baseball. To the mound is number 27, Darren Roberts. He comes to today's game with a 6.75 ERA, 3 wins, 1 loss. He has 12 appearances on the season. He's started 6 of these games. Well, he has a big task in front of him to stop the bleeding, as LA Valley leading this game currently 8-0 with 2 runners on and only 1 out. Luckily, the force is available at third base at this time, but up to the plate, Will White.
That's a good look at Darren Roberts, the freshman out of Highland High School in Palmdale.
First offer up, swing and a miss from Will White.
And Emery, completely different angle, arm angle for Darren Roberts. How much of an adjustment is that for the Monarch hitters?
Yeah, well, you know, they're used to seeing probably a pitch coming around 81 to 85 miles an hour from the right side over top. And, you know, this might have a lot more play with the ball. He's getting a little bit more movement. And it doesn't look like anything that he was throwing in warm-ups was really going that straight. So, yeah, that generates the second swing and a miss. One pitch away from his second out. Marauders desperately need it. Here comes the third pitch. Way outside, ball one. So 1-2 count, 1 out, runner on second and first. This is probably the first day of the year that really feels like summer for these guys as well. So the hydration definitely needing to be a factor. Payoff pitch just outside, ball two.
Roberts with 30 strikeouts and 26 and two-thirds, so he has the ability to get the punch out.
Breaking ball in the outside corner, hit deep into center field, running over the shoulder, making the catch is going to be Jason Zhang, but that's not before the runner at second base moves over. So the
well, this is exactly why Emery with two strikes. It's so important to not nibble too much and still be around the plate. This ball is hit hard by Will White, but the deepest part of the park, and Zhang ends up making that catch in front of the track. And you get the out. The runner does move up, but now you're one out away from getting out of the inning.
Well, the four still available at second base. Sean David did not move over. Fastball, an outside corner called for strike one. Now just one out away. Elvis Park up to the plate. He lined out to the shortstop last time, or his first time up. He hit a triple in the third inning. That was that big base clearing triple. Swung on and missed with a nice breaking ball at the top of the zone. And I think this is enough of an adjustment here for the Marauders. It's going to keep that lineup off balance, and it's only a matter of time. You know, you have to figure out exactly how long that your pitcher style is going to be effective against this lineup. So far, so good, and it seems to have these guys confused at the plate. The 0-2, one pitch away, fastball outside corner, chopped over to shortstop. He's going to choose to throw to first. It throws in time, and that's going to do it here for the Marauders, but not before two runs score, and the lead is now 8-0. You're watching Marauder Baseball on SoCal College Sports. Into his fourth inning of work, Drew Gustafson at 42 pitches total through three innings, and he's exactly where he wants to be if he wants this outing to turn into an extended one. 8-0 is the lead, and that will bring up the middle of the order here for the Marauders, Adrian Jabara, who had a big base hit in the first inning. Unfortunately, no runs were able to be scored, but he moved over the first runner of the day. Hits a hard ground ball over to shortstop, fielded cleanly, thrown over to first. And Tino Valdez will handle things well easily to Will White, and that will be the first out of the inning recorded. Now, the Marauders started out by trying to remove a lot of pitches from the cache of Drew Gustafson, but first pitch swinging here from Adrian Jabara.
And if my memory is right, I want to say Jabara swung at the first pitch his first time up, too.
He did. Yeah, that's what I have in my scorebook as well, Jeff.
And that's one of the advantages that you have as a pitcher when you're around the plate, is you will encourage batters to go after pitches early rather than get themselves down in the count.
Well, nice breaking ball for strike number one to Joe Uribe. 0-1 count, one out. Fastball inside for ball one.
Yeah, Uribe struck out his first time up with two on. Gustafson coming up with the big pitch when he needed it.
Fastball high for ball number two. 2-1 is the count. Yeah, and that was a swinging strikeout on, I believe, another breaking ball. Really find it interesting how Gustafson has been able to use his breaking stuff with his fastball. Comes back with it. 2-2 count. He's gotten into some deep counts.
Just over the outside corner.
Sure. And he's been getting into some deep counts today, but he's been relatively able to allow his defense to make something happen, and he comes back exactly what he did in the first inning, swinging strikeout to Uribe on the breaking ball.
Yeah, taking something off, and Uribe out in front. And Gustafson settling into a groove through 3 2/3. And unlike Thursday and game two of this series, this is not a 1 or 2 run game. But the Marauders still with plenty of time, but a lot of work to do down 8.
Trey Thomas takes ball number 1 inside corner. And Uribe started that at bat out with a curveball for a strike. And that's how it was going to end. See, Gustafson comes back with the breaking ball, and that one for a strike. 1-1 count, 2 outs. This will be his 51st pitch into the 4th inning. Swung on a miss, strike 2. It might, depending on what their strategy has been today with Gustafson, he has not been afraid to throw the breaking ball with 2 strikes. Might get dirty here. Here comes the payoff. Comes back with the curveball outside corner. Umpire wanted it, but he decides to hold off. 2-2 is now the count. Trey Thomas, lucky to be alive. Here comes the 2-2. Swung on and hit hard down the third base line, and this might stretch into extra bases. Thomas rounding first, and the left fielder is just able to get to the ball. And he's going to be held up at first. Well, Thomas, it's a hard ground ball down that third base line and able to ignite something potentially here with 2 outs.
And a good play by Thomas with the play in front of him. Getting to second might be tempting there, but much more important to keep the inning going. Don't want to run yourself out of any potential for a comeback.
Well, and Tyler Olivas definitely did his best to get to the ball in time. And this brings up to the plate, swinging first pitch is Mason Johnson, and he had a nice base hit in his first time up, but that will do it for the inning. So one runner left on, but no runs scored, and the Marauders down on outs. We'll come back to the top of the 5th when we come back. You're watching SoCal College Sports coverage of Marauder Baseball. Darren Roberts will start his second inning of work after actually doing a very good job at the end of the 4th inning. He'll face Brandon Cuervo, Jack Cosacuello, and Tino Valadez. The bottom of the order, 7-8-9. Fastball high for ball 1. Jeff, did I say Jack's last name properly? I need to make sure I'm saying this correct. Cosacuello.
Hold, please.
Swung on and fouled straight back. Count even, 1-1. I like what Darren Roberts is doing. He's kind of coming right after these batters, not afraid to throw inside, outside. See, goes breaking ball inside there. It's a ball, but keeping these hitters a little more off balance. And the one issue that Heilker just ran into is he had no command with his fastball, and he wasn't able to challenge these hitters like this. Advantage Darren Roberts. Fastball outside. That's going to hold up for strike number two. 2-2 count, no outs. Now the wind is kind of blowing in now, Jeff. It's a strange weather system here in Lancaster, California.
As it so often is.
Yeah, fast.
Yeah, I think Cascoluella.
Cascoluella.
That's not an easy one.
Yeah. Well, it's a full count. Payoff outside. Rung him up, strike three. And that's a great pitch located on that side corner. And this is why it's important to throw strikes consistently over a certain spot. We're going to watch this one more time. Man, what a great arm angle to come across the plate with this. Beautiful execution.
Tailing back over that outside corner.
And that's a two-seamer, Jeff. Two-seamer or sinker? It's hard to tell. Depends on what the guy wants to call it. Ooh, fastball high and inside. A little chin music for Cascoluella.
Cascoluella. That's what we're going with. We don't always have the luxury of pronunciations fully provided for us, so sometimes it's a little bit of a guessing game, and we'll do our best.
Cascoluella takes strike number one. One ball, one strike, one out, and I will await the email for the correction on the enunciation.
Yeah, in for Luis Torres, who started at second. And Cascoluella, no home runs, two runs batted in, batting 184 on the season, appearing in his 22nd game.
The 2-1 count bunted down the third base line, and that's perfectly placed. Throw not going to be in time. Not like it would have mattered. Adrian Jabara was off the bag to go grab that ball. So, bunt for a base hit. And
well, Mason Johnson. Go ahead, Emory. I'm sorry.
No, you go ahead.
Saying that, saw this a couple of times on Thursday as well, and Mason Johnson playing a little bit back at third, and this has been used to good effect in the series by the Monarchs, and Johnson maybe a half a step slower getting there, and with the good speed of Cascoluella, he ends up at first with a base hit, and that's just good recognition of where that third baseman is playing.
Well, and it brings up to the plate one of the masters of this play in the second game of this series, Tino Valdez. He takes ball number one, which is high and inside. Here comes the 1-0.
Yep.
Fastball hard
Valdez,
outside.
Valdez, incidentally, 4-for-6 now in the series. So he is swinging a hot bat.
Right. Might I stipulate, before I get too crazy, might I stipulate he had a nice base hit in that third inning that contributed to that 5 runs.
Yeah, this has gotten him back on track after something of a struggle at the plate.
Back pick for Uribe, but not in time.
Yeah, a struggle at the plate a week ago in which he was hitless. But Valdez picking it up here against AVC this week.
So 2-1 count. Trying to keep Jack Cascoluella close at first base. They come to pick back over. And this is just more of an emphasis to make the guy continue to dive over and over and over again back to first base. Make sure he stays on.
No, Cascoluella does have 4 steals.
Here
and
he goes
hasn't
on the steal again. Uribe,
season.
The throw down to second base in time, and he's going to be called out at second base, caught stealing. No.
The ball got away.
The umpire says
from
the
Terry
ball
at
got
second.
Away from Terry. Well, the throw was in time from Uribe, and I would be rather upset. We're going to watch this one more time. 2-2 is the count. It was a strike that crossed the plate, but my goodness. Oh, he dropped the ball on the tag. Well, that is, man, I got a little too excited from my angle, and it assumed that the call was going to be out. Had the umpire even fooled. 2-2 count, runner now on second. Swung on and fouled straight back. Tino Valdez definitely on that one.
Yeah, that was a heck of a throw from Joey Uribe.
I don't think that could have been placed any better from the catcher. That's exactly where you want to be fielding the ball if you're in the middle infield, Jeff. Well, Tino Valdez with a runner in scoring position now. Popped up deep into left center field. Able to make a play on it will be Jason Zhang. Runner not tagging. And the throw over to second base just in time. Wow.
Jack. Yeah, Koskoloela bluffing toward third and goes about halfway. Watch here.
And
try to sneak the throw behind him, cut off by Taylor.
Beautiful. Wow. And that throw was almost beat him to the bag. That, this is why you have to hit your cut. When coaches emphasize why you hit the cutoff guy in practice, this is exactly why they emphasize such things. It's so that you can catch that runner in case he wants to try and maybe make an attempt to go to third off guard. And they were hoping that he might have overthrown it or made a bad throw, because if he does, that extra hesitation is what's going to cause a runner to move 90 feet closer to the plate. First pitch breaking ball for a strike.
Hey, Emory, let's remember that Rockford Peach's manager, Jimmy Dugan, was very big on hitting the cutoff man.
And that is a wonderful reference to A League of Their Own. Swung on a missed strike two breaking ball against Royce Clayton Jr. Jeff, I have the reference right?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, perfect. Yeah. One of my
Good
favorite
job, buddy.
Movies.
It's a fun watch.
The 0-2, one pitch away from getting out of this inning. Runner on second base. Breaking ball outside, popped up right side. This will be playable. Running over to try and make the play on it will be Adrian Jabbar, and he does. He makes the catch, and we will be out of the inning. So heading to the bottom of the fifth, no runs on. One hit, which was that swinging bunt. You're watching Marauder Baseball on SoCal College Sports. Here in the bottom of the fifth, and that will bring up to the plate Jason Zhang as Drew Gustafson gets into his fifth inning of work with only 54 pitches thrown so far. And Jeff, I got to tell you, with pitch counts that low, this is, depending on how his fifth and sixth inning goes, he might be able to get them to the seventh. Starts with a breaking ball for a strike number one.
Yeah, been locating the ball well. Pitch count is down. He's working on a streak of 9 consecutive shutout innings now, going back to his last start.
Makes the appeal over, and I thought that pitch was a little close, but ball one called. 1-1 count here for Jason Zhang. Yeah, just low. Man. Hard to see from this angle sometimes. Jason Zhang swinging, hits it over to shortstop, thrown over in time, and he almost had it. Ground out to shortstop, and the first out is recorded in just 3 pitches. And Jeff, that's a really important stat to keep note of. When guys are feeling it.
Yeah, he's.
Go ahead.
4 hits allowed, a couple of walks, but he's done a good job of scattering them. And when he's been in a couple of mini jams in this one, he's been able to come up with big pitches and keep the Marauders off the board.
Breaking ball for ball number one to Jack Taylor, who has been up twice actually today, but only one of them wasn't a real official at bat. Jason Zhang was caught in a pickoff early in the second, or late in the second inning. Ground ball hit hard to shortstop, and this is going to be a long throw and a potential error here, and it is. Running over to second is Jack Taylor, and he's going to be on second with one out here in the bottom of the fifth.
Yeah, Valdez has a choice on this ball, Emery. He can throw on the run or take the chance and set himself and deliver a stronger throw. He tries to make the throw. As he's on the move, it's wide of the mark, and Rogers ends up at second.
This is, and it's one of those do-or-die type plays, Jeff. When you're moving over to your right as a shortstop, you know, everybody wants to be Derek Jeter and try to make that throw. But you have to understand that, especially as far deep as he was over towards third base, Jack Taylor isn't the slowest guy in the world, and that's going to be a really hard play to make. And he actually delivered the throw almost on time. It goes to say exactly how well that Tino Valdez was playing at shortstop. Nonetheless, we got one out, runner on second base, and that's going to bring up Jack Rogers to the plate. He's going to take a ball on the outside.
Yeah, the throw beat the runner, but it was wide of the mark. And it's a tough play from Valdez, so something of a tough luck error.
And there's
but
nothing that Will White could have
Marauders
done there
with a runner
either
at second. Yeah, he gambles if he stops to plant himself and then deliver the throw that he might be late.
Well, may the error loom big here in this fifth inning. Fouled up and away to the right side. Out of play.
Rogers working
count
on a 9-game hit streak coming into this one.
He walked on his last time up to the plate, and he grounded out to the shortstop his first time. 0-for-2 on the day. One ball, one strike, one out. Runner at second base. And the flag is now blowing directly at me. So the wind is blowing in now, Jeff. I cannot figure it out here. Takes fastball outside, ball number two.
Well, I think it's your standard swirling wind. Mm. I'm sure those that have played in the Bay Area would know something about that.
The 2-1 from Gustafson, way outside. That's ball number three. I will say, Jeff, while on our ride yesterday, when we were moving horses across the desert landscape of Apple Valley, which is just about an hour and a half to the east of here, we encountered a number of dust devils, and I almost lost my hat on a couple occasions. And one time, I almost got bucked out of my horse. So all kinds of fun things happening here in the high desert.
I've seen that hat, and losing that would be a real tragedy.
Well, Jack Rogers, he doesn't get the base hit, but he does draw the walk here, and that will be the second base runner of the inning. One out only, and that brings up to the plate Zach Terry, and we were talking about it a little bit earlier. Kind of in a slump right now. But he has the ability to break out, and maybe it's time right now. Runners first and second. And Drew Gustafson has two base runners on for, I believe, only
the second. This is a situation where I'd like to see Bobby Velasco head out and just give Drew Gustafson a second. Deep breath, maybe a quick word of encouragement. Get him refocused. Big lead still at this point, 8-0. Nothing wrong with getting back to throwing strikes and going after these guys.
Here comes the 1-0, and that's a breaking ball. Nice, right over the middle, Zach Terry. Now 1-1 count with one out. And does this loom big as well with Keon Mosini standing right there on deck?
Yeah, this becomes a critical hitter for Gustafson. And Terry can keep this going. You open the door to a big inning.
Fastball outside, just high and away. Ball number two. And this is exactly what the Marauders need to do in this inning. It's you're starting to get into those middle innings where pitchers start feeling that first bit of fatigue, and whether or not they are drinking enough water or they have enough energy drink or Advil in their system, what name it, whatever your vice is as a pitcher. It's important that the offense is able to identify if you're starting to feel tired so you can give them an extended inning. Breaking ball over the middle of the plate, but low, and that's going to be ball three. Another extended at bat here, and I I will say, uncharacteristically, he's thrown into a couple deep counts here in a row.
Yeah, how many times has he even had three balls as a count, but now he's done it a couple of times in a row?
Five times today, Jeff. Popped up center, and he just got underneath it, and this is going to be enough to move the runner at second. Moving over is Jack Taylor.
That was
90 feet closer.
That was Hawk Harrelson right there. Oh, Terry just missed it.
Just missed it. So the fly out to center is the second out of the inning, and that's a potentially huge second out, but you still have to get through Keon Mosaney. He's walked once today and grounded out to the second baseman, but that was that really big third out where Gustafson made the 40-yard dash from the pitcher's mound over to first base. Potentially a record time.
You know, Emery, I just want to make a quick point that that was a great job by Gustafson to Terry with a 3-1 count. You got to take your chances in that situation. You cannot walk him and keep this inning going.
Correct. Now, first pitch is a ball, but the runner will go and move over, so that takes away the force out at any base. Jack Rogers standing at second. He'll be rewarded with a stolen base.
And it does open up first base for Gustafson as he works to Mosaney.
This one fouled back into the netting, just left. 1-1 count, two outs. Mosaney. Maybe the fire starter here for the Marauders. On deck.
But while we're talking about how great Mosaney has been, should point out that Aiden Jabara does have three hits in the series. All three coming in the games here in Lancaster. So he's swinging the bat well.
Up left side, and this is potentially going to be playable diving, and no, out of play. There's going to be the left fielder, Elvis Park, and he's down for a second, but standing back up. That was a almost potentially inning-ending play.
Yeah, Park just doesn't get quite good enough of a jump to track that one down, does lay out, but can't come up with it. And that potentially a big break for the Marauders.
Well, and Elvis Park, he's
could get out of this inning without allowing any runs.
Yeah, he's right-handed, so as he's coming over, he's trying to reach over with his glove hand to try and make that catch. Just kind of a difficult play there because you're turning your wrist over. Here comes the pitch. Hit hard right side, and this is going to be foul. My goodness. Keon Mosaney lays into one, but in foul territory. Luckily, no cars are parked in that way. Count stays 1-2, two outs.
And good job by Gustafson changing speeds.
Yeah.
That's a breaking ball, and Mosaney out in front.
Most important pitch of that bat right there, and that's going to draw the count to 2-2. Two balls, two strikes, and two outs. Goes with the breaking ball low. If he comes back with a fastball here, I wouldn't be surprised. Trying to draw a string up, or he decides to go double-double with the breaking ball. The 2-2. Breaking ball outside. Count draws full. Runners second and third, full count, two outs in the fifth inning. And Jeff, in his now fifth time going to three balls in a count, check that sixth time. The most important situation of the game so far defensively. Full count pitch, outside corner. He's going to walk him and put the runner at first base. Well, you had mentioned it a second ago, Jeff. It wasn't going to be too bad if you walk Mosaney and send him to first base. However, bases are now loaded, and that brings up Adrian Jabara. And he has three hits already in this series. Maybe he can make a huge fourth hit. Coach headed to the middle of the mound. Go ahead, Jeff.
You work into Mosaney in that situation, and if you're Drew Gustafson, you have first base open. No need to simply groove one to one of the best hitters in the 3C2A right now. You do have that base open, but Mosaney knows the situation, does a good job, shows a good eye. That's one of those ones where I think that's something of a tie between there. Gustafson knows what he has to do, and Mosaney takes the walk that's there for him and puts it on the bat of Jabara now with the bases loaded.
Tabara with an opportunity to break things open here and have a big fifth inning for the Marauders. And I want to mention something really quick. I have the utmost respect for Gustafson's pants. I know that's something that's not talked about a lot on broadcast, but that is like straight up 1980s old school right there. Breaking ball outside corner called for strike one. Check that, 1950s, 1960s old school.
Down there near the socks?
Yeah.
With the low socks and a little.
Yeah. In the 80s, they got a little more tight with the pants. Definitely in the 90s as well. Here comes the 0-1. This one grounded in front of the plate. And that's going to have the force out at home plate, and the out is recorded. Well, Marauders not able to put a run aboard, but they were able to get runners left on base. Three left on base, none scored, and it's on one hit. Marauders down on outs. We'll head to the top of the sixth. Tyler Olivas, Bobby Velasco, and Sean David do up here for the Monarchs. Tyler Olivas, he has been on twice today. He had a sacrifice fly in the first. He was hit by a pitch in the fourth. Fastball in there, strike one. Eight to zero. Well, the Marauders as close as you could possibly get to scoring a run, but not able to do it. The offer swung on, and that will be strike number two to Tyler Olivas.
Yeah, Olivas spending a lot of time on base for a guy without an official hit, but he's been on by an error and walked and scored a couple of times.
Breaking ball outside, and you saw Uribe set up away. Let's watch this one more time. Goodness gracious, swung on and missed Tyler Olivas down on strikes. Beautiful. Comes in with the curve.
And the right-hander still having a lot of difficulty picking up that breaking ball from the right-hander Robertson, that arm angle on the sidearm delivery.
Yeah, watch that from the side. You don't see too much movement there, but it's about a one-foot drop, and that's enough to throw that hitter off. First pitch goes high with a fastball, ball one. Bobby Velasco.
Yeah, a lot of swings and misses on the breaking ball from Roberts in this stint.
Fastball hard outside corner called strike one. And this is exactly what I was talking about. He's been able to establish that fastball in the outside corner, and this is why he's starting to get that strike. And Alker, it wasn't that he couldn't hit that spot. He just didn't do it often enough, and the umpire wasn't going to call it for him. Comes back away, this time a little bit farther outside, ball two. 2-1 count, one out. Bobby Velasco has been on base twice today. He did have that sacrifice fly in the first to score the runner. Fastball outside corner, hit hard but foul. Back to the right side. Makes the count even, 2-2.
Yeah, the combination for Roberts working really well with the breaking ball moving slightly away from the right-hander and then that two-seamer that works back into the right-hander.
All swung on and missed, and he comes back with it, Jeff. Another breaking ball on the outside corner.
and he has retired 7 of the 8 batters he's faced since coming on.
So 2 outs. Hard hit ground ball down the right side, and that's going to be a base hit for Sean David, maybe more. He's digging into the base, and he's headed for second. Ball in the corner, still not thrown in, and he's going to have it to the cutoff guy. And the cutoff guy is Jack Taylor, who now has the ball in hand, and that's going to stop him. Stand-up double for Sean David, a first-pitch swinging, and he took advantage of that fastball.
Yeah, good piece of hitting from David. Seen a lot of the hitters trying to pull that breaking ball to the left side, but David does a good job taking it the opposite way, gets it by Jabara and into the corner for a double.
Was that a breaking ball, Jeff?
I thought it was. But
okay, you know what? I didn't even see the pitch. That's my bad. Oh, starts off breaking ball outside for strike one. Well, 2 out hits, not the worst thing in the world. Will White does have an RBI today on a base hit to the third base side. He's 1-for-3 today already, swung on and fouled straight back, now in a hole, 0-2. The 0-2 fouled straight to the right side. And we will set up and do it all over
and
again.
And White decidedly late on that fastball. And I'd like to see Roberts go right back to it.
Yeah. The big mistake that he can make here is try to go with the breaking ball since the bat is so slow to it. But we will see what they do. Runner standing on second. It's Sean David. This one hit hard left side, drifting foul, and it will be. But that ball clearing the fence probably by 20, 30 feet, Jeff. I got to say, the wind has now shifted to right to left again, and that ball carried in it for sure.
Yeah, got that one far enough inside that there wasn't much that White could do with it except pull it well foul.
Foul by about 30 feet, but 0-2 count remains. Runner at second base. Here comes the pitch. Thrown inside, and this is going to be hit up the middle for a base hit. Maybe the runner comes and scored. Sean David digging for home, and it's going to be cut off by Jack Taylor, and the runner will score. So the first earned run of the game for Darren Roberts comes by way of base hit, double and then base hit.
All this after 2 were out.
Elvis Park now up to the plate. He had that triple in the third, lined out to the shortstop and grounded out to the shortstop. 1-for-2 on the day. In a hole 2-0. Fastball top of the zone, strike one. So 2-1 count, 2 outs, runner still at first. Ball outside, ball 3. Here comes the 3-1. Grounded hard to the shortstop, Jack Taylor. Looking at second base to try and make the throw, but he decides to go to first. Easy throw over to Adrian Jabara, and the inning is over, but not before the Monarchs add to their lead. 9-0 is the score line. The Marauders will be due up at the bottom of the 6th. You're watching SoCal College sports coverage of Marauder Baseball. Well, the heart of the order due up. We got Joe Uribe, Trey Thomas, and Mason Johnson. Now 76 pitches for Drew Gustafson as he starts into his sixth inning. A little bit more pitches than he would probably want after completing his fifth inning of work. But Uribe.
Yeah, I suspect that either way, this could very easily be the last inning for Gustafson on the mound.
Yeah, potentially. It depends on exactly how LA Valley feels about their bullpen. I see a little bit of movement up there. Uribe takes.
Well, we saw Tovar go a little bit over 90, and they made the move to the bullpen on Thursday, and you wonder if that isn't the usual MO for Dave Malice, but we'll see when we head to the seventh, assuming that Gustafson gets through the inning.
Yeah. Anything can happen here with Marauder Baseball. Joe Uribe striking out twice today already. Hit, ground ball, left side, and this one's going to be foul, strike two. Uribe trying to get out of this slump here today. The 1-2 pitch, breaking ball high, and that was the pitch that he had struck out on twice in a row. Not been swinging well at that curveball. You can for sure see Gustafson trying to break it over, but potentially he's playing a little bit tired here. And he does throw the curveball again for a swing and a miss, strike three. So the first out of the inning was recorded to Joe Uribe, and he's walked back
well,
to the dugout.
Well, I got to tell you, Emory, I'm a student of the Emory Johnson School of Pitching, and if I'm not mistaken, that was a pretty good job of changing the eye level on the previous pitch with that high breaking ball, and then he brings it back down after the pitch up in the zone, and Uribe swings through it.
Jeff, you you have studied well. Yeah, that's exactly.
I've been listening.
Comes with the high fastball and comes back with the breaking ball, and that's exactly what he did, Jeff. And that's spot on. Swell starts out with a fastball away to Trey Thomas, and I think he tried to bring some speed up to that one because that was thrown pretty hard there. One ball, no strikes. Comes back outside again, but misses off the plate. And he has certainly been feeling it today. This will be his 84th pitch of the game. In there for a strike, outside corner.
Well, the advantage for LA Valley in this one is if they do go to the bullpen for the last three innings of this one, it's not a one- or two-run lead. It's a nine-run lead. That's a much different situation to come into.
Yeah, you feel a little bit more confident coming out of the mound. You go, well, you know, there's no stress at all. This might as well just be a bullpen for me if you're in the bullpen in that time. Here comes the 3-1. Low for ball four. I'll have the first base runner of the inning for the Marauders, Trey Thomas. On balls. Mason Johnson. Up to the plate now. He had a base hit in the first, flew out to right field for the final out of the fourth inning. Stark difference between the Marauders and the Monarchs right now. The Monarchs are working on their fourth time up and into their fifth time up. They will definitely have five at-bats today, depending on how things shake out for the rest of the game. Outfield now shifting over. Center fielder and left fielder moving to the left side. Wonder if there's a statistical chart giving them that information. Johnson takes ball one. 1-0 count, one out. Runner at first. The Monarchs not stressing too much. Their infield has been able to make a double play today on a couple occasions. That pitch dropped. Ball two.
And now Velasco will come out for a quick word. Maybe going to buy Drew Gustafson a little time to settle himself. Got the huge lead here. Been around the plate all day. And again, just keep going after these guys. Let the defense do some work behind you.
The The 2-0. Outside for strike one.
And Emery, you're there, and as I've watched some of the balls hit, we've seen the ball carry really well here in Lancaster, but not so much today. It's a little more of a pitcher's park today.
Line drive into left field, and you're correct, Jeff. The flag has just been kind of all over the place, but nothing, you know, fully blowing out at all. Nice base hit here for Mason Johnson, and he's now got a nice little day going 2-for-3. That'll bring up Jason Zhang. He was on in the second inning. But outside of that, he grounded out to the shortstop his first time up, or third or second time up. Ground ball hit into the hole right side, and Zhang might be able to produce the first RBI. He does not. Runners hold. And they have two back-to-back base hits, one out here for the Marauders. Runners on all bags, and that will bring up Jack Taylor. Yeah.
Pass the diving Casco Luella, and I think a good decision. Again, you're down 9. Absolutely do not want to run yourself out of a potential inning in this situation. Much more likely to err on the side of caution. Play station to station, at least for now. Well, the base is loaded, and if you're going to make a comeback in this one, this is how it starts. Get some runners on, see if you can string together some hits.
Well, this is going to bring the pitching coach out on the mound now, and I think the pressure starting to mount a little bit here for the Monarchs. Not that they're too stressed out with the 9-0 lead at the moment, but definitely a time to take pause. You have one out on a force at all bases. The runners always...
You know, go ahead, Emery, you could see on that shot there that whatever was said to Drew Gustafson, it got a big laugh, and it reminds me of something that I believe you said to me off the air a couple days ago, that sometimes the pitching coach, you think they're going to come out, have a lot of instruction, talk about a situation, but sometimes it really is just to kind of loosen you up and get you refocused and back, and sometimes a little levity can actually do that, even in a tight situation.
Yeah, Jeff, that's exactly it. Hopefully that's enough to get the pitcher a little bit distracted in terms of what he had to say. You know, it's enough to keep your minds off the immediate situation that's in front of you, which is a little bit daunting. Bases loaded, one strike, you know, one out. That's a lot to deal with. So if you can get your pitcher to kind of settle down and think about something that's going to make him laugh, that's the best case scenario. In his sixth inning of work, one strike, one out. Fastball low.
Hey, let's remember, in the wise words of Ron Washington, it's only baseball.
It's only baseball.
It's a Moneyball reference right there for you.
Yes, it is.
I'm making my tour around the baseball movies in this one.
And I'm loving every second of it, Jeff. 1-1 count, one out. Bases loaded, and Jack Taylor, maybe an opportunity to break things open here. Popped up right side. It might be playable, and it looks like it is. Running over and making the catch, but runners do not go. It's Tyler Olivas. The second out of the inning is recorded, and that's it. Now you're only one out away if you are Drew Gustafson.
Well, that's an awfully good pitch from Gustafson. A little bit below the knees, and Rogers goes after it. Too close to lay off. Or I should say Taylor goes after it. Too close to lay off, but not a pitch that you could do a whole lot with.
Yeah, you know, that's one of those protect kind of counts that you try to just swing at and not totally make a full attempt at the ball. You know, if you know it's going to be a strike and you're trying to protect the count, protect yourself in that count, you might not want to try to hit it. But sometimes that's just how baseball works. You get too much of the ball. One ball, no strikes.
Jack Rogers at the plate. A tie for the team lead with 5 home runs, and there is danger here for Valley. Rogers has the power to take it out of here under any conditions.
The 1-0. Now 2-0. A Well, potentially a sigh of relief for Gustafson, but he has to get through now the top of the order, which is just so dangerous from the for the Marauders. Jack Rogers, he's been on twice already on two walks, so he's clearly at least seen the ball well. And I don't know if it's by design that Gustafson has been throwing around him, but that is how he has reached a couple times. Now three balls and no strikes.
Well, a good at-bat for Rogers. A couple of these pitches have been close to the zone, but he's shown a good eye. And he's way out in front now, three balls and no strikes.
Certainly has a potential to walk a run in here. Three balls, no strikes. Here comes the pitch. And the umpire calls a strike, and this one was definitely low and inside. Might get a look at it for a second here. So 3-1 count. Let's see where this ultimately goes. Man, maybe the umpire was calling it over the middle of the plate. I'm not entirely sure, but Jeff, what's your call there?
Well, it had dropping action on it, so it might have caught the knees as it went over the plate.
Ground ball up the middle. This is going to be a fairly simple play, and Tino Valdez flips it over to Jack Coscoliuela, and that will do it for the Marauders. They are not able to get any runs on for the second time with bases loaded. Well, we will head to the top of the seventh, and Jeff, you will have the play-by-play call. We'll see you in a few moments, everybody.
Darren Roberts has gone 2 2/3 and allowed just one run, but the Marauder bats have not been able to get anything going against Drew Gustafson, and the Monarchs carry a 9-0 lead into the seventh inning. Brandon Cuervo will lead things off as Roberts is back on the bump, and here is the first pitch on the inside corner for a strike. No balls and a strike. ABC in this one, 3-for-12 with runners on base. 1-for-8 at the plate with runners in scoring position, and Gustafson has been very good. Hit on the right side and threw for a base hit to get things going in the seventh. But Gustafson has been very good and even better when he's needed to be.
Well, Jeff, you're exactly right. I mean, you know, in pitching in tough situations, and I would not be surprised to look over and see that there's guys warming up in the bullpen for the Monarchs, and it looks like there's some guys stretching out and moving around. So we'll see if he comes out for the seventh. It couldn't be out of the question.
Yeah, he's got 97 pitches for the outing, according to the live stats. So that is right about the time again. Tovar was, if memory serves, at 92 Thursday when they took him out. And if there's any pattern to how Dave Malice wants to handle his pitching staff, you would expect to see someone else back out on the mound to start the seventh inning. But if that is the case, or even if it isn't, what a gem. And this one for Drew Gustafson going six innings and blanking the Marauders.
You know, the interesting thing, too, is he's held them to six hits. Now, That might not be too impressive of a number to most viewers, but the six hits for the Marauders is definitely very low. We in most of the games that we've covered, they've been up in the 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 type hits. So just an interesting thing to keep note of.
There goes the runner, the throw down from Uribe, the tag from Terry, and he's out. So Uribe gets Cuervo at second, and Emery is at two balls and two strikes or 3-1?
It's 3-1 right now, Jeff.
Thank you.
Yes.
So 3-1 on Coscoluela, and now the bases are empty with one down. Off speed over for a strike, three balls and two strikes.
Well, running yourself into outs
Coscoluela
right there.
With a base hit. His first time up, and the Marauders will take it. With one down as Coscoluela follows that one off. And he will see another pitch, seventh pitch of the at-bat. It's been a lengthy outing for Roberts, but he's been very good now through three innings. Line drive softly to Taylor, who's there. Two down, so off the end of the bat. And again, Roberts continues to do a good job changing speeds and keeping these hitters off balance. And two down, bases empty.
Yeah, Jeff, you're making such a great point there. It's just the change of speeds, the change of arm angle. It's very difficult to pick up for a hitter, especially if you're able to work your breaking stuff that well. And he's done a very good job of that.
Inside for a ball to Valdez, who's had another big day at the plate. He's 1-for-2 with a walk. Scored a run. Valley looking for what would be their 22nd win on the season and looking to take the series 2-1. If this one holds up, they've got the big lead here in the seventh. 2-0 pitch, fly ball right field. Rogers under it and has it to retire the side. Seventh inning stretch from Lancaster. It's all LA Valley. 9-0 over ABC. It's Marauder Baseball and SoCalCollegeSports.com. How good was Drew Gustafson through six innings? AVC at home this season has scored less than five runs only once. That was a three-run outing. And he blanks them through six in Valley. And looking for quite the feather in their cap if they can finish this one off. Against a very good Marauder lineup, Perez, the new pitcher, one ball and no strikes as he misses high. He will work to Zach Terry, Keon Moseni, and Aiden Jabara in the bottom of the seventh. Terry's 0 for 3. Low for a ball, two balls, and no strikes. Perez on the season, a record of 3-2, making his 13th appearance, his ninth in relief, the ERA at 4.60 and 29 in a third innings. Surrendered 24 hits, walked 18, struck out 16. 2-0 on Terry, who's still looking for his first hit of the series. High for a ball. 3-0 on Terry. As the right-hander, Zach Perez, takes over for Drew Gustafson. On the inside corner, three balls and a strike. LA Valley in second place in the Western State South. The conference record of 12-5, but looking up at the juggernaut that is Glendale College year after year.
That's a really nice facility, too,
tough
Jeff.
Tough to keep up with that program, the Vaqueros. So very good year after year, and once again, they're loaded. A walk to Terry to lead things off in the bottom of the seventh.
And never got the chance to play here and never got the chance to play in Glendale. Both of those facilities really, really beautiful. Glendale, really nice baseball field. Well, leadoff walks, Jeff, and, you know, man, we've talked about this in the past, and this has usually been a catalyst here for the Marauders. Maybe an opportunity for them to do something here with Moseni up to the plate.
Gabe Perkins will run for Terry, so Terry will finish his day. As Perkins takes over at first base, and that'll bring up Moseni. Well, even with three innings left, you got to start somewhere, Em. And maybe you could put in a couple, trying to get some momentum going for what would be a spectacular late inning comeback, trailing 9-0. But again, it's got to start with a single run. No balls and a strike. Moseni 0 for 1 with a couple of walks. Breaking ball outside, a ball and a strike. Keon Moseni, just a freshman, leading the team in most major offensive categories. I won't finish the joke from Major League because it doesn't really apply, but it happens to be true in the strictly baseball sense. Two balls and a strike now on Moseni. Batting 455 coming in. Two home runs, 32 runs batted in. And again, Moseni, just a freshman. Perez comes home off speed, over for a strike, two balls and two strikes on Keon Moseni. And Moseni, out of Our Lady of Mount Carmel Secondary School, Mississauga, Ontario. He has made a home here in Lancaster and made a home in this batter's box this season, three balls and two strikes. Perkins at first. Marauders trying to get something going. Outside for a ball. Perez narrowly missing but doesn't get the call. Back-to-back walks for Perez. That is no doubt exactly what you don't want to see. You're in that Valley dugout with a 9-0 lead, and Perez comes in and puts a couple of guys on immediately. And he'll see if he can settle in as he'll work to Aiden Jabara, who's 1-for-3, and a base hit back in the first. Swing and a miss at the breaking ball. And Emery, you're down 9-0. You've got a guy who's having trouble locating pitches. And Jabara, I understand the temptation. You want to go up there and try and make something happen, but he goes after ball one.
Yeah, you know, sometimes that breaking ball just looks super, super good right out of the hand, and you've been seeing it on the on-deck circle, but that perception change will happen when you get into that box. And, you know, he could potentially actually have a 2-0 count at this time, but, you know, the conversation from coach needs at this time to be slow down, take this bat at bat by at bat, and just focus on getting base hits here.
Back up the middle to his right. It's Cascoluela who goes to second for one in the relay. Over, and Jabara able to leg it out, so it's a fielder's choice, but Cascoluela ranging to his right, able to keep it on the infield and get the first out. And that's a big play.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Jeff, you know, what could be two outs with only a runner on third base just turned into one out with runners at the corners, and that's perceptively way different. And potentially a chance for Uribe now that there's a different pitcher in the game to break out of his little slump that he's dug himself in today. Check that. That's
yeah,
a new batter.
Here is the guy who is the most happy to see another pitcher, I think, on the rubber.
Well, Jeff, I got to correct
Uribe
myself.
Joey Uribe was 0-for-3 with 3 strikeouts. We have a pinch hitter.
We have a pinch hitter. It's Chisholm Demers is up to the plate.
Okay, so Demers will come in. Wild pitch from Perez. And the runner at third will stay put, but Jabara will advance to second. So a ball and a strike as Velasco has some trouble with the breaking ball from Perez. So runners at second and third with one down. And, of course, for Perez, the mandate remains a fairly simple one. Just get the batter. You continue to put some outs on the board. You should be fine with a 9-0 lead on the outside corner, a ball and two strikes. Chisholm Demers, 2-for-11 on the season at the plate, appearing in his 10th game. A ball and two strikes. And Perez going to step off. So a chance here for Brian Moses to look down his bench and give some opportunities to some players as Demers, frozen on that one, takes strike three for out number two.
Well, in that position.
Couldn't get the bat off the shoulder.
Yeah, well, in the fifth batting order position, that's 4 Ks in a row. Goodness, that's a rough day over there.
Now Trey Thomas will try to pick up the runners with two down. And the Marauders have struggled in particular with runners on base and in scoring position, but they will come through here, a base hit for Thomas. That will score a run and break through and get the Marauders on the board as Thomas with an RBI single will bring home Terry, or I should say Perkins, with the first run.
Wow, that's just taking advantage of a good pitch that he threw early in the count. You know, he came up to the plate with a plan. When he saw his pitch that he wanted in that plan, he executed on it. And Jeff, that's perfect. Runners stay at the corners, even though there's two outs. All you got to do is put something through the infield, and you're going to continue this cycle of runners coming aboard.
And Mason Johnson is due up next. He's 2-for-3, swung the bat well today. Left-hander Perez ready. First pitch swinging, lined. That's a fair ball into left for a base hit. It'll bring home another run. 3-hit day for Johnson. And the Marauders with a couple across. It's now 9-2. Jabara comes home to score. Still two away. But the Marauders starting to get something going. But they're going to need something very dramatic to get all the way back into this one. Running a little late on time as they bat here in the bottom of the seventh.
Well, Jeff, we got to say, baseball, dramatic? Never.
And particularly here at in Lancaster, where we've seen just absolute craziness. Meanwhile, do we have a pitching change?
That is the pitcher's
coach. Looks like it's Eddie Zapata.
Yeah, I don't know.
I believe I just saw Eddie Zapata, who functions both as a pitcher and plays in the field as well. But Zapata on. So let's keep it here and tell you a little bit about freshman Eddie Zapata.
Yeah, Jeff.
He's making just his fifth appearance of the season. Four innings of work, a record of 0-1, an ERA of 4.5. In four innings, he's allowed three hits, walked two, struck out two. So they go to little-used Eddie Zapata.
Yeah, potentially an opportunity
with a 9-2 lead
for him to establish himself as a as one of the relievers, at least late in this season. You know, it's hard to say. Two runs in four innings of work, that could very well have come from one game. I don't have his season record on hand right now, but interesting that they make that change so quickly, though. I will say it seemed like Zach Perez was really having a hard time of keeping these guys not all over the ball. And as we got through the middle of this order, I mean, every single guy was taking very good hacks at the ball, starting from Keon Mosini. Or check that, not Keon Mosini, but Adrian Jabara. He did hit in the fielder's choice, but that was a hard hit ground ball to the shortstop.
Yeah, Eddie Zapata has two appearances and just one inning of work on the mound since January 31st. So four innings, yes, and three of those four innings came very early in the season. Now, he has been available as a position player as well. But this, obviously, an interesting call. But the Monarchs do have the large lead, and they're going to give Zapata a chance here. And in limited work, Emery, I think it's safe to say he's been solid. So we'll see how he does. He takes over with two down.
Four innings is not a lot. And you know, that's four appearances in four innings. So it's not like he's, you know, had four outings where he's – or four games that he – or four multiple appearances for multiple games and, four innings total. It's been one inning of work, and, you know, all he has to do is come in and chase that one out, and that's potentially what they're hoping he can do here is just get that out so they can get another reliever into the game without burning another arm. And, you know, that's potentially also tactical because they didn't have a guy totally warmed up. And, you know, if you can go out and chase one out, you've done your job as what you call as the fireman. Just stop the fire, stop the bleeding, and, you know, get us into the dugout, please.
Zapata ready. First pitch on the outside corner for a strike. Jason Zhang at the plate. He's now hitting four straight. He's 3-for-10 in the series. And again, big RBI double in the comeback on Thursday. And he'll try to keep things going here in the bottom of the seventh. Continuing to work that outside corner. And now Zapata way out in front. No balls and two strikes. And what do you do here if you're Eddie Zapata? And you want to work to Jason Zhang with an 0-2 count.
Well, Jeff, I would say don't give him anything to swing at. That's for sure.
Zapata ready. Kicks and delivers. And breaking ball, high, a little inside, one ball and two strikes, and that's a pitch that up in the zone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll be interested to see if this is a tactic that's being utilized by the pitching coach and the pitching staff of the Monarchs here. If he comes with a breaking ball, I would say yes, Jeff, and you spotted it out perfectly earlier in the game today.
Yeah, it feels like a pitch that maybe was setting up something. Let's see. Back to the outside corner, on the ground to second, over to second to retire the side. So Zapata does the job, comes in and gets Zhang to get out of the inning. But the Marauders put two on the board. On two hits, they leave two. We head to the eighth, L.A. Valley on top, 9-2. It's Marauder Baseball on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Top of the order, Royce Clayton Jr. due up, to be followed by Tyler Olivas and Bobby Velasco. In the top of the eighth, LA Valley on top, 9-2. Expect to see some changes in the field. First pitch swung on by Clayton, a drive to left, back. It's going to be off the wall on a hop. Clayton with good speed will easily cruise into second with a double.
Well, Jeff, I got to give you a weather report really quick so that we can understand the context here. The flag is hanging directly down. There is no wind at all, and that ball did not carry one bit extra as it was hit off the bat of Royce Clayton Jr.
They didn't even give me a chance to get into some of the changes in the field, but Gabe Perkins is on at second, replacing Zach Terry. First pitch to Olivas, over for a strike, no balls and a strike. Demers, Chisholm Demers comes in behind the plate to replace Joe Uribe. A couple other changes still to report as well. One is Shea Lewis on in left field, and we just saw Lewis getting that one back in off the double from Clayton. So Shea Lewis takes over for Keon Moseni. And Moseni actually moves to right to replace Jack Rogers. So Moseni moves from left to right, and Rogers' day is done. And no sooner do I say that than I have to correct that, as Jack Rogers has moved to first
right
to replace Aiden Jabara. Now Aiden Jabara's day is done. I'm
okay.
Comfortable saying that. So try to update on some of the changes. But it's probably more confusing now than ever. But suffice it to say, some changes in the field for the Marauders in this one. A ball and two strikes on Olivas.
Now, Jeff, I'm gonna need you to say
Moses,
that.
Is Brian Moses trolling me by just replacing guys but then moving guys around?
I think so, Jeff.
Is he just having some fun with me?
I had that conversation with him before the game, and I think that was well-received. So,
popped up, and Moseni has it for the out.
Oh, my goodness.
Tagged,
Jeff, I don't know.
Put.
I don't know if you just saw that. Moseni just threw a ball on the fly over to third base. And
Dave.
Mason Johnson just caught that
Dave
ball
Parker
about
special.
Chest high.
Yeah, I was going to say it was a Dave Parker special right there from right field. That's not a baseball movie reference. It's an All-Star Game reference. But
yes. I think that was a statement.
About as old as most of my baseball references.
Sure. I think that was a statement right there more than anything.
Yeah, Moseni, who has played left and right, also some shortstop this season, and wherever he is, he's got a strong arm. One ball and no strikes on Velasco. And there is a look at Darren Roberts, who came on back in the fourth inning to replace Willem Hauker and has done a terrific job keeping Valley somewhat within sight. But it took the Marauders all the way to the seventh inning to break through it all, and they still trail at 9-2. Velasco, 1-for-2, singled, was walked intentionally, sacrifice fly, and struck out his last time up. High for a ball, two balls and a strike.
Well, and to think about all the runners left on base between the fifth and the sixth inning, Jeff, I mean, nothing short of a dagger. You had two runners in scoring position in both innings. One of them with only one, or both situations with one out, and they were only able to scrape away two runs through three of those innings. But the two runs did come by way of two out situations. So the Marauders scraping from the bottom of the barrel, as they say, to try and get anything across as of today.
Three balls and a strike. Yeah, it's a game that could have been different. I think it's safe to say, not only with the chances that the Marauders have had at the plate, but think back to the five-run inning back in the third and the error that played a key role and some balls that just found a way to drop, and Hauker with some unfortunate timing with control problems. And you give the Monarchs all the credit in the world. They made the most of it. They have the lead, as they should. But this is one where the Marauders maybe – could have been telling a different story as they try to go to third to get the lead runner, and it would appear that Clayton Jr. made it, just beating the throw.
I want to watch this again. That was very close, Jeff, and deceptively close from this. Oh, we have the perfect camera angle for this. And I think the tag, the tag beat him. That's irrefutable. Let's roll that back one more time, Shalette. If you could give me a little bit of a slower view of that one more time. I don't know what frame this one is. Oh, here we go. The full thing.
Initially, Johnson's leg is in the way.
Yeah, I mean, he's protecting the bag with the ball in hand.
Now, Emory, I'm going to ask a basic question. I'm going to let you answer this. But you saw on that play, interestingly, Mason Johnson gets his leg down in front of the bag, and that stops Clayton from getting his foot to the bag on the slide initially, and then he pushed through and eventually got to the bag. But Mason Johnson is allowed to do that. He can fully block the bag with his leg.
You got me there, Jeff. I believe if he has the ball, which he did, he's allowed to block the bag. However, I don't know if that rule only applies to home plate. It'd be worth looking into, and I hate to sound amateur in my commentary here, but I really actually – that's a great question I would like to have cleared up. Because to my knowledge –
I put you on the spot a little bit.
No, that's okay. I mean, I should probably know this, but to my knowledge, I know that's the case at home plate, so I don't know why it wouldn't apply any other bag.
Yeah, I didn't see them giving an indication that they were discussing more of an obscure rule like that. I think the call on the field, as we admittedly have to speculate, is that Clayton just beat the throw as opposed to making a call about – the runner being impeded in some way and therefore being awarded the base. So it's really neither here nor there, it would appear. But I thought it was interesting that Clayton did not have access to the bag on the initial slide.
Sure.
Having to work around Johnson's leg.
Yeah, if
no balls and two strikes.
If we were able to actually come back with video evidence, obviously we don't have any replay at this level of baseball, but I think the throw and tag beat him there. I think the umpire got the actual call wrong, but whether or not a blocking the bag in that instance is the case, I think you're right, Jeff. I think they were arguing. Ooh, fair ball.
Davis with a fair ball down and into the corner. This is going to score a run. Lewis over to retrieve. We'll get it back in, but Valley answers back with a run here in the top of the eighth on a double by Sean David. Well, Roberts came on in the fourth, and you have to consider that fatigue can be a factor. It's been a lengthy outing in relief. That went a little up in the zone, and David turned on it.
Yeah. Yeah, Jeff, he hits a good pitch there and does exactly what you want to do, is put a ball in the corner if you can. You know, try to take it the way that it's going, and that did a good job on getting the runners in.
Sean David. Incidentally, with a big day at the plate now with three hits and a sacrifice fly, a couple of runs batted in. A ball and a strike on Will White. White's 2-for-4. That one going to get back to the screen. David going to advance to third. Two balls and a strike. And, guys, help me out here a little bit. Is it 10-2 or 11-2?
It's 11-2. The runner on first base actually came all the way around to score, Jeff.
Yeah, so the double from David actually scored both Clayton and Velasco. So we'll update the score there to 11-2. And now David at third, with only one down and the count evened up at two balls and two strikes. So give David credit now for three RBIs in the game to go along with three hits. 2-2 on white. Well, this one starting to look a little bit like game one of this series, which was a 16-4 win for the Monarchs, and just a team having a great season playing great baseball. And the Monarchs are doing it all. They got a great pitching performance, and they're coming up with some timely hits. And they are firmly in control here in the eighth. Outside for a ball. Elvis Park on deck. Chopper to third. Johnson will look the runner back. Over for out number two.
Oh, that's a great catch there, Jeff. You know, Johnson doing a great job of being a great defensive third baseman there. You know, getting the ball and not immediately throwing it over, but checking your runner on third. Even if you don't think he's going to go, just give him a check, make sure the guy's not getting super far down the line. And, you know, it's the simple baseball mechanics that are really important at this stage of the game. You know, 11-2, that's a tough score line to consider coming back to in the bottom of the eighth and maybe the bottom of the ninth here. But making sure that you don't make the easy mistakes, you know.
Park arguably struck the biggest blow in the game with the bases clearing triple in the third. That gave Valley a 5-0 lead at the time, and they've never relinquished control from there. Fly ball, deep right center. Zhang giving chase, but he won't get there. It's all the way to the wall. Park into second, around second, and he's got two triples now on the day as Valley pushes the lead to 12-2. Four runs batted in for Elvis Park. He's now hitting six of his last seven, and he's having a monster series, 5-for-12 in the series.
Those are numbers that are scary for a pitching staff to look at, especially when you're analyzing the data there, Jeff.
And for Park, those are his first two triples on the season. And no balls and a strike on Cuervo?
One ball, no strikes, I believe.
Okay. 1-0. Ground ball right side. Perkins will go to first to retire the side, but the Monarchs answer back in the eighth. They bring in three runs on three hits. And no errors, one left on base. We're heading to the bottom of the eighth, and LA Valley back on top 12-2 here on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Jack Taylor set to lead off in the bottom of the eighth. And with the lead back out to 10 runs at 12-2. Andy Zapata will continue on the mound for the Monarchs after he got the final out, getting Zhang on a fielder's choice in the seventh. First pitch to Taylor inside for a ball. One ball and no strikes.
Well, Jeff, at this point, it's all about making sure that you just continue to work on the fundamentals of the game.
Two balls and no strikes.
And the rest will take care of itself.
On Taylor.
If the opportunities present themselves to the players and you start getting some runs going, then it's time to start looking to be a little more encouraged. But, you know, play the game the way that it's going to go.
Two and one. Yeah, always teaching moments for AVC. Overall, 15 and 20 on the season. 6 and 11 in conference. Fouled away, two balls and two strikes. And the Monarchs appear to be well on their way to taking this series. And they continue their outstanding campaign. And you got to believe they're going to be part of the postseason if they can keep things up. 22-15, and again, 22-15, if they get the win here, this will be their 22nd win. Fly ball, right center, Clayton Jr. there, and he will make the catch. And, of course, if the name Royce Clayton sounds familiar, there's a reason. Son of former major leaguer Royce Clayton Sr. And I remember Clayton on at least the Giants and the White Sox. I usually like to name as many of the teams as I possibly can. And Royce Clayton Jr. Initially set to go to the University of Hawaii, but bounces back to L.A. Valley. But obviously he is a terrific young talent and will be continuing his career after he finishes up here at L.A. Valley.
Whew, Jeff. You got two of them. Would you like the full laundry list of organizations?
Did he play for the Rockies as well?
Sure, yeah. That's one of them.
All right. That's three.
Yep.
I feel like I'm doing reasonably well on my Royce Clayton trivia.
This is
no balls and two strikes.
Very good at this point.
So I said the Giants, the White Sox, and the Rockies.
Yeah, that's good.
And, at this point, I would probably be guessing. So, but I know he had a tremendous major league career.
Yeah.
And was he on the White Sox in 2005?
No, in 2005.
Okay.
Yeah. Nope. Oh.
Driven deep to left, back in front of the track, park underneath it, and has it for the out. And I'll tell you, Rogers gave it a ride, but that is a good statement about how hard it is to get one out of here today.
Yeah, if there's no flag
as that
movement.
One dies, yeah, short of the track even. After Rogers, who has the power to take it out of here, gave it a ride. And that'll bring up Gabe Perkins. Perkins came on as a pinch runner for Zach Terry back in the seventh. So he gets an at-bat here in the bottom of the eighth as Zapata has come in and set down three straight, trying to close this out for the Monarchs. One ball, no strikes. Yeah, I was wondering if Royce Clayton was on that White Sox team that won the World Series. It was 2005, wasn't it?
No, I believe so. Was it 2006, maybe.
Yeah.
Well, it was the San Francisco Giants between 91 and 95, the St. Louis Cardinals in 96 to 98, the Texas Rangers from 98 to 2000. And when I say laundry list.
Should have had the Cardinals.
Yeah. Well, yeah, St. Louis Cardinals. Though this does not stipulate which major league organizations he played for. It just says professional teams.
Two balls and a strike on Perkins. And, yep, it should have had the Cardinals. Okay. But I did okay.
Yeah, you did.
Two
excellent.
And one.
I mean, to know all
on
these
Perkins.
Things. Ooh.
Well, listen, it's that well inside to Perkins, and it got him. So Perkins hit by the pitch and a two-out base runner. And that'll bring up
hit him right in the
Keon
neck.
Mosseni. Yeah, this one, as we'll watch from this angle, and just gets away.
Well, you wear a helmet for a reason.
So one down, I should say two down and a runner at first, and now Moseni will be the batter. Said that I just wanted to say that I can come up with a lot more teams the players played for if you go back a little bit further, because that's where my Stratomatic play comes more into play, and that's where I can name everybody.
Wow, Stratomatic.
Royce Clayton Sr. came a little bit after all that, so yeah. I only know some of the teams.
Yeah. Royce Clayton Sr. played his MLB debut September 20th, 1991 for the San Francisco Giants. And then his last appearance was September 30th, 2007 for the Boston Red Sox.
Uh-huh.
He batted an average 258 in Major League Baseball, which is actually impressive in its own right. I mean, there's a lot of guys who never even batted above 200.
Are you kidding me? 17 years in the major leagues? That's pretty impressive.
Yes, it is.
Bouncing ball in foul territory for strike one. And that's a lot of that information that we got is thanks to Mike Cepeda, who he never stops working, executive producer here at SoCal College Sports. And whether he is there in Lancaster or not, he's always working and always watching. No balls and a strike. As we have a pinch hitter for Moseni. This one low, a ball and a strike. Zapata ready. Just inside.
Now Jimmy Williams coming in for Moseni. He's batting .333 on the season. He's played in four games. He's had three at-bats, one run on one hit, and one RBI. So that helps the batting average if you look at the statistics.
Yeah. An opportunity for Williams and a snap throw down. And the runner back. So a ball and a strike on Williams, who getting just his fourth at-bat of the season. Give you one more look. And inside, or I should say that's the look back on the throw. And now we'll bring you back live. A ball and two strikes.
No, full count, Jeff.
On three balls and two strikes, thank you. Yeah. On Jimmy Williams, two down, a runner at first. We're at the bottom of the eighth in L.A. Valley, out in front 12-2. Payoff pitch to Williams. Swing and a miss. Williams goes after it, comes up empty, and that'll retire the side. No runs, no hits, no errors. One left on base. We'll head to the ninth. Monarchs closing in. They lead at 12-2 on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Heading to the ninth. And Jack Cascoluela will lead things off. New pitcher for the Marauders. And first pitch, high for a ball. And the new pitcher is Ryan Freschini. Swing and a miss from Cascoluela. Count even up at a ball and a strike. Ryan Freschini. Let me just correct that very quickly. Ball and a strike. Outside for a ball, two balls and a strike.
Well, nine innings pitched so far on the season. Nine ERA on five innings pitched in five appearances. Four hits, five runs, five earned runs, six walks. But he has seven strikeouts, Jeff. That's a pretty good little stat to pop out there. So just over a strikeout an inning.
He is behind Cascoluela, three balls and a strike. And here's the pitch, fly ball, shallow center. And that one caught. Williams actually coming in to make the catch as he takes over in right for Moseni. Look at this one as Williams will call off Perkins for out number one. That'll bring up Valdez. Off speed, in for a strike. No balls and a strike on Valdez, who's one for three with a walk. Count even up at a ball and a strike. And Mike also mentioning that, going back to Royce Clayton, that does a lot of terrific charity work in his career and after, including a lot of notable work with the Jackie Robinson Foundation. So the terrific career, and then, of course, so much good work during and after as well. Fly ball caught by Williams for out number two. So quickly two down in the top of the ninth inning for L.A. Valley, and Freschini making quick work of the Monarchs. And due up, it is Royce Clayton Jr. We'll see if Clayton Jr., who extended his hitting streak to eight games with a double in the eighth, will be the batter. And it looks like it is. All right. So no balls and a strike. Clayton Jr., one for two with a couple of walks and a sacrifice. Three runs scored. Terrific game for Clayton Jr., who's now 4-for-11 in the series. We'll quickly correct the count to two balls and no strikes. Freschini ready. Line drive into center. Another base hit. Fifth hit of the series for Clayton. On again. So a two-out base runner. And it'll bring up Olivas. Olivas 0 for 4 on the day, has been hit by a pitch. Has scored a couple of times.
That is potentially one of the strangest 0 for 4 lines that you will ever see. Jeff, he's got a sacrifice.
So true. Yeah,
sacrifice fly, but then he got on with the error, the hit by pitch, and then struck out and then flew out. That's quite the statistical line there.
Yeah, it's been eventful despite not having a hit in the game, but it feels like Olivas has been part of the action throughout. Slow curve, a beauty, a ball, and a strike. Looking ahead to next week, L.A. Valley will finish out their season with a three-game series against the conference-leading Glendale College Vaqueros. So a chance to test themselves again. Fouled off. Meanwhile, ABC back in action. We do have another game coming up here on the Marauder Network next Thursday as they take on L.A. Mission. So the last home game of the season will be Thursday, and we'll have it for you here on SoCalCollegeSports.com. 0-2 pitch, and Olivas lays off. A ball and two strikes. Emery, you're going to be right back out in Lancaster on Thursday. We're going to
– That's right.
We have split coverage on SoCal College Sports. We'll be here in Lancaster. We will also have the men's volleyball championships, the semifinals, on Thursday night as
hey,
well.
Getting a little bit busy during that weekend, I have to say. And then we got swim and dive coming up the following weekend.
See, this is all news to me. You know, they only tell me so much here.
They only wake me up for the
important meetings. Fly ball to center and deep. Zhang on the run. He's not going to get there. So Olivas comes up with an extra base hit. Clayton off with contact is going to score easily as Olivas ends up at third with another triple. And L.A. Valley, after two are out, a single from Clayton, a triple from Olivas, and they extend the lead. How about Clayton Jr. at the top with four runs scored? 13-2 now in favor of the Monarchs.
That's
and Fascini, who was on his way to having an uneventful inning, has run into some trouble.
Talk about being a participant for your offense there. Four runs scored, my goodness.
And Bobby Velasco, the batter, 1-for-3 with a sacrifice fly. Three more runs batted in. And you look at the last seven games for Velasco, and now I say that, and of course we have a pinch hitter, so Velasco not at the plate. Those were the numbers for Velasco, but Miles Gravel will pinch hit, so the sophomore with an at-bat. Line drive, sinking, and it'll drop into right field, and it's going to roll and keep on rolling. This will get all the way to the wall. Gravel digging hard. Around second, they'll wave him into third. Here comes the throw, not in time. And Gravel, with his first triple of the season, brings home Olivas. And now it's 14-2. And watch the hitting here from Gravel. This is a good piece of hitting. Emery takes it to right center.
Almost identical location, at least in where the ball was going to where Tyler Olivas hit the ball. And I mean, that's just a super large part of the alley. It's 384 to the corners here, Jeff. I mean, this is not a short park by no means, no stretch of the imagination. So, I mean, lots of time to run if the ball is running to the corners, and those outfielders are separated by probably 180 feet or more.
And that'll bring up Sean David, who's had a big day at the plate. Popped up and out of play. So a ball and a strike for David, who has three hits and three runs batted in this one.
Yeah, he had that big stand-up double there in the sixth.
Yeah, hits in each of his last three at-bats, so he is warm to the task. And he drives this one to deep left, back at the wall, and it's off the wall. So David with another extra base hit. The Monarchs teeing off here in the ninth after Fascini got two outs quickly, a single followed by two triples and now a double. 15 on the board for L.A. Valley, and they are running away with this one. Looking ahead to a date with Glendale next week. And I'm checking the I'll check the standings very quickly, the updated standings, to see if technically if they could pull off the highly improbable sweep. Could they still play for a share of a conference championship? But let's so one ball and no strikes. Another pinch hitter at the plate. This is David Ramirez appearing in his 12th game. He's 2-for-13 at the plate on the season. Two balls and no strikes. Looking at the Western State South. And LA Valley right now in a tie for second at 12-5 with College of the Canyons. And they are three games back of Glendale. So with this win, they're still alive if they could do what would be incredibly impressive and sweep the Vaqueros. They can still pull even with a tie. Two balls and two strikes as they're three games back and well on their way here.
Well, and I'm just checking right now. Canyons, the other team that's in that race, Jeff, they're tied 8-8 at the bottom of the ninth. Might be important to take a look at that because Canyon's also playing for that first place spot at this time.
And it could be important when you talk about seedings when the postseason starts. If LA Valley can get a second versus a third in the Western State South, and how might that impact? Cold strike three. That will do it for the top of the ninth. But LA Valley with three more across. We head to the bottom of the ninth. Monarchs on top, 15-2. We'll head to the bottom of the ninth. And Emery just following up on what you were saying at the top of the inning. They are in the bottom of the ninth, and that's Canyons mm-hmm. at Glendale. So.
Well, I have an update from that game, actually. The live scoreboard is not updated, but I checked their little live stream that they had going, and Glendale did walk off on Canyons. They had bases loaded with one out on the bottom of the ninth and came up with a big double there to put things over the top. Glendale will hold on to first place, obviously, but Canyons, again, locked in battle with LA Valley, is going to drop down, at least according to RPI, and all things considered, I believe LA Valley, unless a couple things go massively wrong here in this ninth inning. I suppose LA Valley would probably take that position, but it is based on RPI, but that does shake some things up there in that playoff race.
Yeah, LA Valley will move into sole possession of second in three outs. But tough assignment in the last week, so College of the Canyon certainly still very much in the fight for that second place spot, because Glendale with just one, or I should say two losses in conference.
Right.
And 15-2, now 16-2. Leading it off, it'll be Shea Lewis. Shea Lewis batting 267 on the season, 4 for 15 at the plate, a home run, 3 runs batted in. And a reminder again, next Thursday we'll be back here in Lancaster. Marauders taking on L.A. Mission. 1-2. Do have a new pitcher as well after Eddie Zapata goes 1 3. He will hand it off to Andy Rodriguez. Tall left-hander making his 15th appearance on the season. 2-2. Rodriguez 2-1 with an ERA of 4.43 and 22 1/3. He's allowed 16 hits, walked 15, struck out 23. 2-2 on Lewis. High with the fastball, 3-2.
Well, he has one listed game save, or in the game saved, he has 0 listed in that column, and I wonder if this is his normal job as the closer, but I'm not entirely sure.
Low for a ball and a walk for Lewis.
You know what?
Off the ninth.
I will correct myself. Daniel Tovar, who pitched last Thursday, and Danny Veloz are their normal guys who come in for the saves. 12 and 11, respectively.
So Rodriguez now will work to Chisholm Demers. Demers fouls the first one back. He had a cut, no balls and a strike. Well, Rodriguez mentioned the tall frame, and he's a 6-foot left-hander out of Valley Glen, Summit View High School, and Emery appears to pop the glove pretty good with the fastball. No
looks
balls,
like a heavy
two strikes quickly on Demers.
Looks like
yeah,
a heavy
that one
fastball
had a little. Yeah, I wonder, that had more of a sinking action. We've seen a couple that were a little more up in the zone. Mm-hmm. Might he throw a couple of different fastballs in his repertoire? Here's the 0-2. Breaking ball swung on and missed by Demers. And Rodriguez fans Demers for out number one.
Yeah, just like that curveball. Exactly where he wanted it on the outside corner. That's going to generate a swing and a miss, especially how he started that at bat.
And that'll bring up Nick Hagan. Freshman will pinch hit for Trey Thomas. Well, it appears that the Marauder win streak on SoCalCollegeSports.com is going to come to a halt here today, and this one with Valley leading at 15-2. They'd won their first couple here on our streams, and they'll have a chance to get back to it on Thursday. But generally speaking, I think it's safe to say over the last year plus, we've been pretty good luck for the Marauders, who do tend to play very well here at home. A ball and a strike, but not so today. They've run into a bit of a buzzsaw. Here is Gustafson was terrific on the mound, and the Monarchs come up with a number of clutch hits, and they have pulled away in this one, a ball and 2 strikes. Now on Hagan. Hagan for the season, batting 258, a home run, 13 runs batted in. The 1-2 from Rodriguez, breaking ball, and Hagan just gets a piece. From the belt, here's the 1-2. Upstairs with the breaking ball, 2-2. See Hagan on that left side. He's right on top of the plate. And Rodriguez tries for the outside corner and misses. 3-2. Gotta believe we're going to see a fastball here from Rodriguez.
Which one is it, Jeff? I don't know.
Right. Back up the middle and through for a base hit. So Hagen with a single, two on.
Well, Jeff, I got to say, that's the one place you don't want to throw that fastball, actually, in that count. In the full count, you're trying to keep a strike, but you don't want to throw it up in the zone or in the middle of the plate. You generally want to try and pinpoint something on the corners. Don't let the situation get too crazy for you. And that was just a simple mistake. He should have been trying to locate somewhere else with that pitch, at least in my opinion. But others may disagree with me.
Daniel Munoz, a redshirt freshman, will bat next. He's batting 250 on the season. No home runs, 13 runs batted in. 52 at bat, so he has been part of the lineup on a fairly regular basis for Brian Moses. Takes the first pitch, a breaking ball at the knees for a strike. And, you know, worth reporting now that Josh Nuno, who was batting 423 with five home runs and a team leading 42 runs batted in, he's missed the last seven games and haven't had a chance to have a direct conversation with Brian Moses. But this is a Marauder team that, as good as they've been and as hard as they've battled, really has lost one of, arguably, maybe their best player in their lineup this season as well. A ball and a strike. And Nuno is a sophomore, and we'll see where he goes next, but he is a tremendously talented player going back to last year in our coverage as well. So the Marauders at 15 wins on the season. Have had to battle some adversity this season. They've been very good here at home. Mentioned over 500 at home, but the Western State South is tough. And they're going to say that that got a piece of Munoz, so the hit-by-pitch will load him up. But it just shows last year, ABC with a 20-win season, but how – tenuous it is here in the Western State South. It's a strong conference, and just a bad break here or there can really make the difference.
I'll also tell you, Jeff, in the 3C2A alone, from just the baseball perspective, you know, in some sports it varies, but I will say in baseball specifically, you get such a high talent level, and the margin for error in a playoff run is very, very small. Most of these teams are within a couple games of each other and coming down to the wire for the playoff race. I recall my career when I was playing at Moorpark. On both occasions, we were within a game of first place, and we just failed to win a baseball game in the last couple games of the season. And that was the difference maker. You know, you're working on a 25, 26, 27 game win season, you know, That's enough to put you into the playoffs, but you know the margin, like you said, the margin for error very small, and the talent level is very high, especially at the top end of this division and this league.
Yeah, and every year it would seem it's only getting more so that way.
Yeah.
With more and more talent coming in, and the collection at the top getting tighter and tighter. Every year. New pitcher is Tyler Olivas, going to come in from right field.
He's got a little side slinging action here, Jeff.
And again, that will be an adjustment. Now you switch from a left-hander to a right-hander and an arm angle that maybe you haven't seen.
Is this borderline submarine? What do you think?
I would say so.
He's really getting down there.
I'm getting Dan Quisenberry vibes.
Who is your favorite submarine pitcher, Jeff? All time.
Well, I'd say, of course, I grew up with Kent Tekulve, you know, in the watching Kent Tekulve in the National League.
That's
and of course, how can you not like a guy who was a smoker? That's from the days where Kent Tekulve was well known to be a smoker, and sure, when you could just come in and get guys out, why not? don't have to be able to run a marathon in 2 hours. But Kent Tecovey, who else was there? There was Dan Quisenberry, Mark Eichhorn, Chad Bradford, if I can come forward a little bit. Gene Garber. Has there been a left-handed submariner that you can think of?
Ooh.
Why
is Google at my I have Google at my availability here, but I got to really think about that.
Yeah, there's an age-old question for you. Why is there not a a left-handed submarine pitcher? And obviously, if there is one, maybe we'll get word of that. But I'm not. Everyone that I named, and those are the ones off the top of my head that I can name, they're all right-handers, and it does seem to lend itself to the right-handers. First pitch swung on and fouled off. Meanwhile, for Olivas, 4 innings on the season, an ERA of 0 with a save. In 4 innings, he's allowed 1 hit, walked 1, and struck out 4. As the batter is Chuck Lang, who will bat for Jason Zhang. In the incredible possibility that somehow ABC could put together one of the biggest ninth innings in the history of baseball at any level, it'd be interesting to see how Brian Moses might have to scramble to put a lineup out there, as he has pinch hit for every batter here that he can, trying to give an opportunity for some players to get some swings. As Chuck Lang is the latest. But fortunately for that eventuality, it seems a little unlikely in a 15-2 game. Low for a ball. 2 balls and 2 strikes on Lang, who is 3-for-13 at the plate on the season. No home runs, 4 runs batted in. And he's got a chance to add to that total here with them loaded with only 1 out. Olivas in from right field, trying to close it out. In on the hands. Over to second. They try to double up the runner, but can't get it. Now they'll go back to third, and they will get the double play to finish it off. And oddly, somehow, Emery, that seems a little bit fitting for today. It was a little strange, and it went decidedly L.A. Valley's way as they close it out 15-2. It's a final.
Yeah, Jeff, I don't know if I can really recap it better than that. This has been a game that's been decided by a couple major errors that were on the end of the Marauders today. Not to take anything away from the 17 hits from the Monarchs, but a simple running error like that was just a total descriptor, and I'm sure that will be in the conversation piece in the team meeting after today's game for the Marauders. But you know, had a fun time along the way anyways. It's 4:18. We started at 1 o'clock, a 3-hour and 18-minute game, Jeff.
Yeah, the Marauders with the loss dropped to 15-21 on the season. They're 6-12 in conference. The ever-so-brief one-game win streak is snapped here in a 15-2 loss. For their part, let's just quickly update for L.A. Valley. They move to 22-15. They're 13-5 in conference. They're 3 games back of Glendale, and they will take on Glendale in a 3-game series next week, the final week of the season. That will wrap up our coverage from Lancaster. Final score, once again, LA Valley 15, ABC 2. You have been watching Marauder Baseball here on SoCalCollegeSports.com. Thanks so much for joining us, everybody. So long.